seen the time, by the way.
Hang on a sec. I want to talk about these raccoons.
Stimulating late-night sporting debate for long-distance lorry drivers.
40 for the copy.
Young mums.
What time do you call this? Coming on?
And students who've taken too many of those caffeine tablets. The two mics, Parry and Graham on Talk Sport.
Look at the light!
They say if you can smell toast, you might be about to have a stroke.
Well, I smell toast all the time. I love the smell of toast, don't you?
What do you mean you smell it all the time?
Well, you smell toast. You put toast in the toaster.
I'm talking about when you're not making toast.
Oh, no, no. Well,
like when you're walking down the street and you smell toast.
No, you can't be mad. I thought you meant you smell toast when you put in your toaster, you fool. What are you laughing at? What do you expect me to think? What do you think?
It's not about smelling toast when you're actually toasting bread.
Well, when else would you smell toast?
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics, and I'm delighted to say that as Christmas gets ever nearer, it's time to say a very, very good morning and a sort of happy holidays type greeting to Mr. Mike Porky Parry. Very good morning to you, Mr. Parry.
And a very good morning to you, Mike. And you're right, Christmas is getting closer.
It is.
But you know what? It's not Christmas that I'm looking forward to.
What are you
it's not Christmas
to?
Eve I'm looking forward to.
What is
it's
it?
Not Boxing Day I'm looking forward to.
No. What are you
looking forward to? I'm looking forward to Monday, the 28th of December.
Are you?
That's when we launch ourselves on Talk Sport's daytime audience.
Oh, yeah, okay.
A return to the daytime schedules for the two mics, and bang, is it going to be explosive?
It will be great, yeah. I'm looking forward to that too. Hopefully you won't have overindulged over the prior weekend.
Not at all. I mean, actually, we're giving it a good old whack here in the studio on Christmas Day itself, are we not?
We are indeed. We shall be here live in the early hours, as Santa, in fact, is running around the world delivering his presents.
Absolutely
right.
One
of the things I'm going to do is get the Santa tracker out so that we can tell you exactly when he's coming over Southwark, exactly when he's coming over
That'll
Manchester,
be fantastic.
Exactly when he's coming over Glasgow. We can do all that.
And we'll be here till 4 a.m. On Christmas
Day. We certainly will,
day.
Yeah.
Yes.
I get an early cut. I get to go home the same time as you.
You get the
you know,
same
which
time
will be
as me,
first
yeah?
for me.
Yeah, well, it is, actually, because normally I just leave you as my wingman to finish the programme off when I've gone home after the quality part of the show. You know
that,
what I mean?
Yeah, that's what some people say.
Yes, yes.
Now, what about the FC Santa Claus gift? Because we've got a picture out there
Absolutely
on Twitter.
Absolutely marvellous. Thank you very
FC
much
Santa
indeed.
FC Santa Claus, great name for a football club. I mean,
it
if you ever wanted a second favourite football team up near the Arctic Circle there, FC Santa Claus, if you haven't been
what
on Twitter...
What exactly are they? Some sort of scientific outfit, are
no,
they?
No, because they come from the Arctic Circle, they figure they might as well call themselves FC Santa Claus, as that's where Santa Claus lives.
Yes, but sorry, is this a Norwegian team then?
Well, yeah, they're up there in the Arctic Circle.
Yes.
Finnish, I think they are.
Oh, Finnish?
Yeah.
They're Finnish, are
it's
they?
It's kind of Laplandish.
Lapland,
yeah.
Okay, Finnish Lapland, that's great.
Yeah.
And they've got a football club up there. What
and
sort of pitch do they play
club?
On?
Well, they've got, I mean, they only play obviously when there isn't any snow there. So, I mean,
well, there's snow all the time, isn't there?
No, they play at certain. No,
in,
they play
in the
in
Arctic
summer.
Circle.
No, they play in the
is.
Summer. No, there's not snow all the time.
It usually is.
No, there isn't. No, they don't play on snow.
Well, the only problem is they can't play in the winter because it's permanently dark.
Well, they don't play in the winter, they play in the summer.
Play in the summer, do they?
I mean, have you never paid attention?
Permanent light.
Have you never paid any attention to this show? I mean, we have this guy on a regular basis.
Yes, yes, I'm aware of that, but I'm talking about the detail of what it's all about.
We've had the chief executive on the show a few times.
We have. Have you put the picture out yet?
We have put the picture out.
Who's in the team?
Well, the team is a team of four.
Right.
And it was pointed out that you can't really have a team of four.
Yeah.
So I can only say
Well, the goalkeeper was missing.
The fifth member would have to be Santa himself, presumably.
Exactly.
And that's what we're waiting for. So the team is you and I, Mr. Dave Levine, the executive producer, and Mr. John Hearn, the very talented man behind Glass.
Excellent.
Who has no title, but he prefers not to have one.
You're talking about the man with no name?
The man with no title.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly.
So,
right.
So that's gone out, has it?
So let me tell you about it. The club was formed in 1993 following the amalgamation of Rovaniemi Raipas and Rovaniemi Lappi football clubs.
And this is in Lapland?
Yeah.
Right, okay. But it's part of Greenland, Lapland, isn't it?
Well, no, it's part of Finland.
You sure it's part of Finland?
It's definitely part of Finland.
Okay, yeah, good. And who do they
Finland,
play against?
Finland, actually.
Finland, yeah. Who do they play against?
Well, they play in the Kakkonen, which is the second division.
Oh,
of Finnish football.
Oh, that's excellent.
And in the northern group of that, right?
So they're a professional football club.
Oh, yeah, they are, yeah. They've been over here. They've come over here and played friendlies and stuff like that.
Right,
in fact,
okay.
last time we spoke to their chairman, we were going to try and set them up with a few friendly games.
Ah, right, okay.
So I think they're hoping to come and do that. You know, and they like to come and play their friendly games sort of before their season gets underway.
Okay, what
towards
do they,
the end of our season.
What do they do about training in the summer when it's, of course, it's 24-hour day light, isn't it, in the summer?
Well, in those parts,
how do they sleep?
In those parts of the world, I mean, people do all kinds of things at all strange times of the day and night. I mean, the kids sometimes are out playing at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
Because they're encouraged by their parents not to worry about the fact that, you know, because it's supposedly night time, you have to sleep, even though there's no light.
It's good. It's good. Good thinking. Okay.
Well, we'll have to get the guys on, won't we?
Well, indeed, we must.
And then Nick and answer all your questions.
Yeah, I mean, they very kindly sent us a set of shirts there. That's quite a I wouldn't say unique shirt, because unique means one only, but it's quite different.
Well, it's very different. It's red and it's got
probably
FC
unique,
Santa Claus.
Actually. Probably is unique.
Well, no, you could say it's unique. It doesn't have to just be one of them, does
no,
it?
No, that's true. No. Unique means one of a kind.
Yeah, but that's the same as, I mean, people misuse all sorts of words, like decimated.
No, but what I'm saying
people
is...
People say, oh yeah, the whole town's been decimated. But actually, decimated means reduced by 10. It doesn't actually mean destroyed.
Well, people misuse
that word all the time.
Yeah, but that's the literal interpretation.
Well, it's the same as unique. I mean, you can describe a unique radio show, even if there's two people on it.
Yeah, but the radio show itself is unique because it's a one entity.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, but
You've got it.
But you can also have a unique radio station. You can have a unique football shirt.
Yeah, you can, yeah.
You know, you just said you couldn't.
Yes, you can.
You just said you couldn't have a unique
football shirt. If it's one of a kind, you can. The only thing I'm thinking is there another football club anywhere else in the world called Santa Claus FC?
No.
We don't know that.
And this one's not called that either.
What's it called?
It's called FC Santa Claus.
FC Santa Claus, you see? So there you go.
No,
so there could
one.
Be a Santa Claus
No, it's
FC.
The only one.
In that case, it's unique.
It's the only one in Finland
and good.
In Lapland.
I'm very pleased to hear that.
You got that clear now?
I've got that clear. Now then, that's all very good.
Yeah.
Now, the thing is, although we get tomorrow morning's papers tonight,
there
won't be anything about Spurs' new ground.
It won't, because the meeting at Haringey Council apparently went on until midnight.
I saw a picture of Mr. Levy, the employee chairman of Spurs, who was talking about what great benefits it's going to bring to North London.
Yeah.
And I saw him sitting
Exciting for Spurs fans, obviously.
I saw him sitting in the public gallery at Haringey Town Hall.
Yeah.
Which took me back all those years to when, as a young reporter on the Chester Chronicle, I used to cover the council meetings for the Chester Chronicle.
God, that must have been boring.
And, yeah, it was terribly boring. And I used to sit in the press gallery of the council chamber in Chester Town Hall.
Well, they actually had a press gallery.
They had a press gallery,
yeah. How many seats did they have in that?
Oh, quite a few, about 12.
12?
Well, look,
how many people do you think wanted to cover it?
Used to have to cover two councils, Chester City Council, which used to look after things like, you know, plant pots and things.
Yeah, yeah.
And Cheshire,
see, I bypassed all of that.
Cheshire
I that
County Council, which used to look after things like traffic management schemes and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Right.
And I have to say, what used to happen was the meeting used to start at 6 o'clock, and we used to go to the pub and get bladderated between 5 and 6.
Funny that.
Mm. Because the guy who ran the booze next door to the town hall was actually the Dublin Packet, the one that used to be run by Dixie Dean,
right,
on the town hall square. But he knew us well, because the pubs didn't open until 5:30 in those days. So he always opened half an hour early.
I'm already losing the will to live.
No, he opened a half an hour early so that a few gentlemen of the press and a few of the councillors could connive together to decide which were the good stories on the agenda, so he didn't have to read through it all.
Well, so he didn't actually have to attend the meeting either.
Well, you did attend the meeting for about half an hour and then went back to the pub and got completely bladderated, waited until the council meeting had finished at about 10 o'clock, then the councillors came in, and then they told you what had happened.
Yeah.
In exchange for some drink.
Yeah.
And that, in that way...
But what if they gave you the wrong impression, or what if they reported incorrectly?
Well, you used to talk to both sides, you see. You see, you know,
but even so.
Balanced reporting.
Yeah, but even so. Mm. That's not balanced reporting. That's not reporting at all.
Well, it
that's
is.
That's taking two different versions of an event
and
trying to make it up.
Yeah, that's right, just welding them
it's
together.
A shocking state
but
of
most
affairs.
People...
Surely your point of view being there is that you can be the independent source.
Too boring. So I used to cover the council meeting from the pub, and the thing is that council meetings are so complicated anyway that it didn't matter whether my reported version was right or wrong. Nobody understood it anyway, so it didn't matter. No, seriously.
That's a ridiculous thing to have to do, isn't it, really?
Yeah. No.
So what was the most important decision that ever came out of this council?
Oh, I think knocking down the town hall itself and building a new council chamber or something like
that's
that.
That's some ludicrous price.
Yes, exactly.
Well, shouldn't you have done the story on what a waste of taxpayers' money that was?
Well, I didn't like to be controversial.
No, because also you were in the pay of the council.
Exactly, I just said it was voted through.
You see, I mean, you know, you get into journalism supposedly to be a seeker of truth and justice.
Yes.
That's what you've claimed.
Yes.
And actually, all along, your career has been completely and utterly punctuated.
Not at all.
By doing favours for people,
not at
getting
all.
Freebies for people, you know, concealing stories, you know, keeping the facts away from the public.
Not at all.
You know, you're the worst kind of advert for journalism. You know, you should actually be behind bars.
When somebody used to write in and say, you know, I attended the council meeting because I'm very concerned about the new road layout scheme in Blaken, you know, which is the electorate of Chester.
Yeah, yeah.
And your report on it was not what I heard in the council chamber. You were handed the letter by the news editor and you say, OK, don't worry, I'll take this to the highest level.
Did you blame the subs for subbing it out?
No. I used to say, we'll take this to the highest level. Mm. And that was a joke because...
Right.
There was only one shredder in the office, and it was on the top floor. So he used to take it up there and put it in the shredder and never refer to it again. And the guys who complained never wrote back. I mean, you just ignored it.
It's a shocking admission of how your career started.
Yeah, I mean...
And it never really changed.
Occasionally, when some irate reader would turn up in the front office to say, your report from the council meeting, I was, you know...
Would you dash down the back stairs and out the back door?
No, I used to go down and say... The problem with you is you don't understand. Yeah. And then I'd tell them a version of events, which I completely made up on the spot, to say, no, what you don't understand is the contraflow system, which applies to that part of the road, will only be introduced subject to a contraflow system on the other side of town voted in.
Shame, though.
And these people would say, oh, right, well, thank you very much indeed. Yeah. And they'd wander off down Bridge Street thinking they'd learned something.
Happy. Mm. They met this very talented, young, thrusting reporter who could sort everything out for them.
Yeah, absolutely.
I feel quite unwell having heard that.
Right.
Because, I mean, you know, I'm a journalist. I like to think of myself as having uncovered a few, you know, important truths in my time. And to have to sit next to you and share, you know, a platform with you, having known what you've done and the way that you've operated, but it makes me feel quite sick.
But it's called rat-like cunning.
No, it's not. It's called cutting corners.
For instance,
it's called keeping things from the public. It's called corruption, frankly.
One time, I think I've told you, haven't I? I had to go and cover this time of the year, the gang show in the Chester Gateway Theatre. And it was the local scouts who all used to get on stage and sing... We're riding along on the crest of a wave, and you know there's all these little scouts pushing wooden waves
up
and down the stage.
Didn't you leave early or something? And then something
well,
happened.
The thing is, I had an assignation that night with a very attractive young lady, so I said to the guy from the other paper, "Look, I've got to go. Do you mind?" And he said, "No." And I rang him the next morning.
Yeah.
And I said, what happened? He said, I don't know. He said, I got bored after half an hour. I went to the pub. Yeah. I said, well, who's was anybody left? He said, no.
Right.
So we made it up together.
Right.
And then because our reports in each paper coincided and basically said the same thing, everybody who sort of wrote in and rang up and said that wasn't what I saw at the gang show, we called them drunk or stupid.
That's horrible. Yeah. That's just horrendous.
I know, yeah.
It's just dreadful.
Yeah.
We've got lots of things to talk about tonight. We've got Chelsea seems to be moving closer towards getting a new manager.
Yes.
Spurs getting a new stadium. We want to talk about that. We've got Porkyvision coming up, of course, a little bit later on. And we're going to be talking about darts as well.
Why are we into darts tonight?
Well, because the darts competition starts tonight. The WDC.
And it's the 2016 competition, by the way.
It's the 2016 competition.
You called it the 2015.
No, I didn't.
Are you sure?
No, I'm very sure.
I thought you might have.
No, I didn't. I just called
it. Because it starts in 2015, but it finishes in 2016.
So it wouldn't be unusual to call it the 2015, but obviously the 2015 already has happened. So, I just called it the WDC.
Oh, did you?
I didn't realise you had to put a year in front of it.
Yes.
I mean, obviously not the 2009 WDC.
No,
anyway,
exactly.
We're going to talk to Paul Nicholson, and we might recount that story of when you cheated and beat me at darts that time over in...
I didn't cheat. I had a female partner,
over
and
in Mayfair.
She was very good.
Do you remember her name?
Scandinavia.
This is Talk Sport.
Talk Sport on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM. The enduring home of football.
It's modern radio, only better.
Talk Sport.
What Britain did to me, made an act of tea. Made an act of tea. The East India Company granted a monopoly. 773 and they just keep taxing, never think of asking.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Coming up a little bit later on, we're going to talk to Paul Nicholson. We're also going to have a little bit of a peek behind the Star Wars magic.
Yes.
We're hopefully going to get somebody on. John Hearn's going to be on a bit later in the show, but we're hopefully going to get somebody on who will be, as we speak, watching the new Star Wars film.
Excellent, that's great.
So that's going to be very exciting as well.
Right, do you know what that record was?
I don't actually know. What was it?
Well, it was all to do with the fact that today is the celebration of the very famous Boston Tea Party.
Oh, right, OK.
OK?
Mm. Is this the date that it happened?
Yeah, on this day in, was it 1774? I think it was 1774, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was 1774. And the world has never been the same, of course, because that was the start of the American Revolution, which meant that the start of the end of the British Empire, America suddenly decided to go on their own. We became a smaller country, they became a bigger country.
Mm.
But very significant, nevertheless.
Yeah.
You know what the Boston Tea Party was all about?
Well, it was all about the taxes, wasn't it?
It was all
about the tea that was coming in from, I guess, the British Empire.
It was actually 1773.
Was it?
Mm, okay. I said 1774, didn't I?
Did
I don't
you?
Know why, yeah.
Yeah, well, 1776 was the sort of Declaration of Independence,
yes,
wasn't
that's
it?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, I remember being in America, I think, for the...
Tall ships arrived in Boston,
yeah,
do you remember?
For the anniversary of that,
yes,
some point
right.
or other. Anyway, well, was it not all about the duty that was the Americans were being forced to pay on the tea and all the other things that were being brought in by the British clippers?
Well, the banners that they paraded around said no taxation without representation.
Yes.
They were colonialists, but they were made to pay huge taxes to fund the British Empire.
Right.
And they kind of objected to that. So it's all the tea.
Which you can understand, really.
Of course you can understand. I mean, that actually...
And funny enough, they don't like tea anyway, the Americans.
No, they don't.
They've never really drunk it ever since.
No, they were tea traders. They threw it all into the harbour in Boston, and that polluted it. It tasted awful. After they scooped it out and started tasting it, thought, why do people drink this anywhere in the world?
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
And they stopped dealing in it. You're absolutely right. Mm. But you would have thought that people like, you know, Gordon Brown and Lionel... was it Lionel Barber? No, Tony Barber. Gordon Brown, Tony Barber, Geoffrey Howe, former chancellors of the Exchequer in our lifetime... Mm. Might have realised that the original lesson of high taxation without representation was that you lost the country and we lost America.
Yes.
You'd have thought they'd have learned that lesson, but they never did.
I mean, in a way, that wasn't because... I mean, they weren't moaning because they didn't like the fact that their representatives weren't doing what they wanted them to do. They didn't actually have any representatives.
No, they
that
didn't.
Was the point.
Exactly.
I mean, you
absolutely.
Can't really say that in this country. In this country, you do actually have a representative,
whether you like what
they do or not.
What I'm saying is that all my life, I've fought against high taxation.
What do you mean, all your life?
All my life.
Well, how have you fought against it?
By not paying it. Basically, because...
But that's not fighting against it.
Well, it is.
I haven't said you joined the Taxpayers Alliance, for example.
Well, I don't join that because I think writing letters to people is a waste of time. Mm. I think what you have to do is actually take more direct action. So
when was the last time you tied yourself to a railing or something?
No, I didn't do anything like that. And I'm being rather mischievous as I don't pay taxation. The reason I've raised this today is because I've been with my accountant for the last two days.
It's that time of the year,
and I'll be paying a huge amount of taxation in January.
So will I, yeah. It's that time of the year.
You know, I've had to...
And happily. I mean, I don't mind paying tax.
I mean,
I object to the way that they sometimes waste the money they collect.
I don't mind paying tax to run an efficient country. What I do mind is paying tax to stupid politicians who wasted on things like cycle superhighways, which people don't want and don't use.
Did you see, by the way, up in Scotland, they had their budget today, or yesterday, I should say. John Swinney from the SNP got up, and this was the first opportunity they had to raise income tax, if they wished, as part of the new settlement from
the
government, right?
Yeah.
And guess what they did?
What?
They almost completely aped George Osborne's budget. They didn't raise their income taxes, and they did exactly the same sort of policies to try and do exactly what the Tories are doing.
Really?
Yeah.
Why? To equalise the economy between Scotland and England?
Well, no, because, I mean, they've been moaning for years that, you know, they want to have the power to raise their own taxes, they want to have the power to, you know, and they want to tax the rich, and, you know, all these things they want to do. They did none of them.
Mm-hmm.
They did absolutely none of them.
So they're all mouth and no trousers.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Donald, where's your trousers?
Donald, where's your trousers?
Was never more true. Now,
I've just come down from the island.
No, I don't want you to sing that. Now, let me read you a few tweets. Ross says, looking at the picture of the FC Santa Claus, that Santa shirt is looking a bit snug on Mr. Parry. Maybe just have one fish and chips rather than two in Wetherspoons.
Bit harsh.
And here's one from Becky, who says she spent 2 weeks in the Arctic Circle in Tampere, Finland in the summer.
Wow.
It never got dark, and I saw Tampere FC play at midnight.
Hey, brilliant. Well done.
From Becky in New Zealand.
Which circle was she in?
She was in the Arctic Circle.
She should have been in the Antarctic Circle, shouldn't she?
What?
Shouldn't she have been in the Antarctic Circle?
There isn't an Antarctic Circle.
There is. It's a...
Where is it, then?
Well, it's down under. It's
in the Antarctic?
Yes.
There's
exactly.
no circle there, though.
Well,
you know... It's not known as the Antarctic Circle,
no,
is it?
No, but you know what I'm talking about. I mean, there is...
Well, the Antarctic is the Antarctic.
The Antarctic is closer to Becky in New Zealand than the Arctic. I don't know why she flew halfway around the world to the top of the world. She could have gone to the bottom of the world.
Well, maybe she wanted to go to the top of the world.
By the way, do you see...
That's
some...
like saying, why would somebody go on holiday to the Mauritius when they could go to the Isle of Wight? What's the point of that?
Yeah, well, the point of that is the Isle of Wight's very pleasant, actually.
Uh-huh.
Queen Victoria used to have a home there.
Yeah.
I read the other day about some chap who left his job as a teacher in Scotland and took a job for $27,000 a year as the warden at a scientific research base in the Antarctic.
Uh-huh.
And the nearest place to it is Puente del something in Chile, the tip of Chile, right?
Right.
And he never sees anybody for 6 months and all this kind of stuff. And he thinks it's...
You know what I mean, that Del Fuego place?
Yes.
Isn't that part of Argentina? Sierra Del Fuego?
It may be, but this particular location point is Chile. Because, I mean, they're unparalleled to each other down the bottom of South America.
Yeah.
I know, because I'm a bit of an expert in South America.
Yeah, we've seen that. We may have to do a quiz on that.
Yeah, maybe.
At some point.
And he said the isolation is almost... sort of heavenly, you know, it's therapeutic.
Well, it drives a lot of people crazy, though.
Yeah, it could do.
They can't do that.
Yeah.
Here's one from Zobon. He says that size X jersey on Porky will stop his blood circulation in his body.
Well, you know, it looked very compact, I agree, but actually, I can only just about get it over my head, to be honest.
Yeah.
But
why is that? Is your head swollen?
No, my head's not swollen. It was a small shirt.
Just metaphorically speaking.
Yeah,
Matt says if he was dead, Clark Kent would be superhumanly spinning in his grave at Porky's criminal approach to journalism. Which I think is very true.
Well, Clark Kent was a very poor journalist. I mean, he was a geek. He was a geek American
journalist. He never got any of his stories right, did he?
Never got any stories right. Never.
Well, he was too busy saving the world.
Yeah, never broke any exclusives or anything like that, you know. And in fact, a bit of a deadbeat when it came to, you know, the written word, you could tell.
Mm.
Mind you, Lois Lane liked him, so, you know.
Indeed.
Can't all be wrong.
Here's one from Kenny. It says, FC yes. Santa Claus, who's their manager? Jose Mourinho.
Jose Mourinho.
Very good.
All right, that's
really funny. We should talk about Jose Mourinho, because I can detect, right. And you're very good at detecting these yes. things because of your years yes. of experience. Mm. I can detect a slight shift from the reports of yesterday
yes.
about Jose Mourinho to the reports of today.
Is
they
that
had
right?
this big meeting that went on for ages and ages and ages, right?
Yeah, but that's just a board meeting.
Yeah, it was just a board meeting, yeah, but yeah. I can detect that. You know what happens after these meetings is people come out, like yes. your council meetings,
yes.
and they brief the journalists and they tell mm-hmm. them what's happened. And yeah. it seems to me that something has happened, which, although one of the back pages says, Jose, your job is safe, there's an awful lot of kind of what you would call audible noise
around
the story. Do
you know what
story,
I think's happened? Do you know what I think's happened? And I'll tell you why. I think that Jose has very skillfully manipulated the situation to his own advantage by convincing the board that it is actually the players and not him.
Yeah.
And do you know why I think that?
Because I think he's convinced everyone it's the players and not him.
Because he goes on TV today and starts blasting the players.
Yeah.
I feel frustrated with some, and I feel others give absolutely everything. Some of them need to look at themselves. Now, the Chelsea
and he's
TV...
And he's talking about how some of them need more passion.
Yeah, of course he is,
you
yeah.
know, that football is not just yeah. about, you know, turning up and playing.
Yeah. Now, Chelsea TV is the official voice of Chelsea football.
It is.
Right? In the same way that, for instance, Sir Alex Ferguson banned the interview with Roy Keane going out when yeah. Roy Keane attacked his fellow players, you
right.
know, and said that these boys have got to give more.
Yeah.
And said, I'm not having that. And then got rid of Roy Keane. In the same way, there will be some sort of censorship policy at Chelsea, right from the very top, because
yeah.
Mr Abramovich is not a Democrat. Everybody who's ever met him will make that clear. He is a Russian,
yeah.
and Russians don't do democracy.
No, why would
they? In that sort of...
also, why would he be?
Situation. I mean,
he
exactly.
runs,
why should
the
he
club,
be? Why should he be?
He runs it any way he wants, right?
You know, I think it's fair to say Mike Ashley's probably not a Democrat at Newcastle. Mm. Yeah, as far as they're concerned, they own the clubs to do it their way. And if there was any sort of issue regarding... Jose Mourinho's future at Chelsea, that TV interview would not have gone out on Chelsea TV.
No.
So my view is he has convinced the board that the mistake has been a lack of investment at the start of the season and that that's going to be rectified by more investment.
Yeah.
That's my view.
Right.
That's my view.
Except that we heard yesterday yes. that that wasn't going to happen. Now, I've got some very disturbing news here because there was another tweet from Becky who's looking once more at that picture of us. And what I've noticed is, you know, I'm the only person in this picture without a beard.
Is that right?
Yeah, because you've got a beard, haven't
yeah.
you? Albeit a very strange
looking
one. Levine's got a beard. Hearn
yes.
has got a beard. Becky, because in the picture you can see Levine and Hearn in the front, right?
Yes.
She sent a tweet that says, the two in the front are quite cute.
Yeah.
Don't tell them I said that.
Yeah, OK. Well, you know, Becky, I thought you were a woman of taste. But anyway, there you go.
Clearly not.
But, I mean, as Elizabeth I, the great Elizabeth the Queen, you know, I may have
Elizabeth
the body...
Elizabeth I, Queen.
Elizabeth I. I may have the body of a weak and fragile woman... Weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a lion,
yeah.
right? This is Elizabeth I.
Well, not in your case. You've got only a third of your heart works, and you told us yesterday how you had that ball of fat removed from your stomach, so actually you couldn't make that speech, could you?
Do you like mocking people who have health afflictions, do you?
Well, you can't
is
make the speech.
You do?
All
is
I'm saying
do?
Is, yeah, in your case, yes.
Is this what you do?
In your case, yes. yes.
Sign of comradeship, is this?
Yeah,
is
well, in your case, that's what I do, yeah. yeah.
Anyway, to...
the time.
To finish my point, well, hang on, I've got to finish this point. As Elizabeth I said, kissing a man without a beard is like eating your chips without salt and vinegar.
She never said that.
She did.
Rubbish. This is Talk Sport.
Get a generous helping of the latest odds and tasty tips with Paddy's Punts every weekday afternoon from 4 on Drive with Durham and Goffey on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome. With the form on the football.
But what a game.
The going on the GGs.
And they're off.
The crack on the cricket.
Six.
And lashings of Paddy's famous generosity.
Ah, come on, gives a break to me a bit of crack, isn't it?
Get your tips while they're hot with Paddy's Punts. Weekday afternoons from 4 with Adrian Durham and Darren Goff on Talk Sport with Paddy Power. You're welcome.
Driving experiences at Mercedes-Benz World are the perfect Christmas gift. From under 17s driving to 4x4 and high-performance AMG experiences on our handling circuits, there's something for everyone. Prices start at just £45. Call 0370 400 4000 or visit mercedes-benzworld.co.uk to buy yours today. Mercedes-Benz World at Brooklands, just off Junction 10 on the M25.
Because road conditions change in a second,
BMW's intelligent four-wheel drive switches power from rear to front wheels in just 1/10 of a second.
From rear
to front. From front
to rear. From rear
to front. Delivering grip that's almost magnetic. xDrive. Available on models across the range, including sports hatch, saloon, coupe and touring. To find out more, visit your local BMW centre.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics. There is, of course, Porkyvision coming up a little bit later on. And right now, though, we're going to talk about darts because it happens to be later on today. The PDC gets underway at Alexandra Palace, as you heard Ben Fletcher saying just then. And Mike, I know that you're quite an aficionado. Did you not used to be known as Dead-Eye Dick when you were a darts player in your student days at Nottingham? Let's talk to a proper man who is, of course, British-born. He's a Newcastle fan as well. Mm-hmm. Paul Nicholson. Paul, a very good morning.
Hi there, how are you?
Yeah, very well indeed.
Very well, thank you.
Thanks for staying up so late to talk to us. Should you not be getting some sleep before the big event?
Well, the bad news is I'm actually not playing in the World Championships this year, so I can stay up as late as I like.
Oh, right. Oh, OK. I had no idea you weren't playing in them. So tell us about your experience in them last year, then.
Last year, I went into the tournament not in great form, but I came up against a young man from Holland called Benito van der Pas. And we were involved in a very, very good match, which went over 5 sets, and he just pipped me at the end. But Benito has actually had a fantastic season this year, and he's really kicked on. So well done to him. But for me, it's been the worst year of my career so far. But I'm just having a little bit of a break so right. I can make sure I've got a right comeback coming.
Paul, just talking about darts on the broader scale, I heard Phil the Power Taylor talking today saying, well, I'm getting older, my eyesight's going, my health isn't as good as it was, I don't sleep as well. Now, something's going on in darts. Either there aren't very many good darts players around if Phil the Power Taylor is still, you know, winning championships, or Phil the Power Taylor is one of the greatest sportsmen in the history of sport. Which of the two is it?
Well, it's really hard to pick between the two. I mean, Phil's right. He's not getting any younger. And to be honest with you, all professional dart players can't wait to see the back of him because he's been stealing money out of our pockets for years.
Yeah.
But as far as dart is concerned, there's just too many good players coming through. And as a result, Phil is not so much on the slide himself, but people are starting to overtake him. And I don't think it's got anything to do with his age. I just think everybody's getting better. And it's all his fault, really.
It's bound to happen. He's a bit like the sort of Tiger Woods of darts, isn't he, really? I mean, he was at the top for so long that eventually he had to kind of get beaten from time to time. And I suppose when you're used to winning everything and you start to lose the odd one, it starts to get a bit irritating.
That's exactly right. I mean, to compare him to Tiger Woods is very comparable. You know, Phil's won over 200 titles worldwide on TV. And Tiger's had roughly the same kind of success.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think you can really compare them figure-wise or, like, workout-wise. But as far as flinging ballistic missiles, there's nobody better than Phil ever.
Right. You're absolutely right. Now, a couple of years ago, Paul, I played an exhibition match against Michael van Gerwen. And I found him a most intimidating man. He didn't speak to me, didn't want to speak to me. Give me that terrible...
Well, I don't blame him. Nobody wants to speak to you.
Gave me that terrible stare, you know, like he hated me or something like that. And his face to me looked like a pumpkin looks on Halloween, you know what I mean? He's a very unattractive man, and therefore he's
ugly. This is pretty good coming from you.
Yeah. His ugliness and his sheer sort of callousness in terms of, you know, not wanting to be very friendly really put me off him. Is that one of the reasons why he's the favourite. Why he himself is a champion?
Well, I think the reason he's a champion is not just because of his ability, it's because he really just doesn't care about anybody else on the dartboard. And it speaks volumes for the champion that he is, that he may have played against yourself or possibly one of the other best players in the world. Mm. He just doesn't care. He wants to win every game he plays. And he's got this incredible aggression that just can't be replicated by anybody else, in my opinion. That's what makes him so incredible.
Well, sorry, if you're an aggressive darts player, how does that show? You know, darts players throw darts at a board. They don't go around beating up their opponent before they do it. You know, they're not like a boxer sticking the nut in or something like that.
It's all psychological, isn't
it? Well, I'm asking a professional darts player, Mike. Would you just shut your mouth and I'll get a proper answer?
This is what happens, Paul. Yeah. He just turns nasty if he doesn't get his own way.
So what sort of aggression does a darts player like Michael van Gerwen exhibit on the hockey?
I think for Michael, the most important thing is that he shows his ability first, and then by hitting big scores like 180s and then big finishes on doubles, what he does is he then turns around and shows his aggression to the other guy as if to say, you're not better than me. I'm going to be the best in the world. I am the best in the world. And he proves it with ability, and he just backs it up with the aggression that he has. And the only way to shut him up, really, is to hit your own 180s and hit your own doubles. But the thing that people have been comparing Michael to over the last few years are things like the Incredible Hulk.
Yeah.
Because that's, he does really explode with emotion, and it makes for great watching.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds to me like a rotting stag-type approach to the game. You know, a rotting stag.
Well, you've just said that it's not... How can you be an aggressive darts player?
Well, because...
So now you've said it's a rotting stag. So which was it?
Well, Paul's just explained to me. It's the sheer body language, isn't it, Paul, of his approach to the game, yeah?
Yes, absolutely. And one other thing as well. I remember doing some commentary work on the radio a couple of years ago, and I actually spoke to Carl Froch, who was right next to me, and I said, would you like to be on the end of one of those left hooks of Michael van Gerwen while he celebrates? He said... Probably not.
No, exactly. So,
he's very aggressive, but I tell you what, he does not use it well.
Mm. But is it also all about confidence as well, Paul? I mean, we've been watching, you know, some amazing football over the last sort of few weeks in this season of the Premier League, where Newcastle have suddenly come back from the dead, where Leicester have gone out and just, you know, slaughtered anybody they feel like slaughtering because they feel like they can. I mean, you've said you've had a terrible year at darts, is a lot of it about confidence when you're standing there just looking at what you want to do, but you can't do it?
Absolutely. I think confidence is probably the most prevalent word in sport right now. And Michael van Gerwen does exude that. I mean, there are other players on the circuit like Gary Anderson and Peter Wright especially, because they have this wave of confidence at the moment. They have so much belief in their ability. And I think comparing those guys with the likes of Leicester City is very apt right now, because if you ride that wave, you just feel like there's nothing you can't do in your sport. And when that seems to go away, you have something called professional doubt. Mm. And the guys like Michael van Gerwen and you know, young Vardy and all of his compatriots at Leicester City just don't have any doubt at the moment. They just have so much confidence. And they're just riding that wave. And it's a very, very dangerous thing to have in sport, because you just feel like there's nothing you can't achieve.
Mm. Tell me this, Paul. You've been in the game a long time now. Would you say that Barry Hearn and his organisation turned sport from being a pub game into what it is today?
Do you mean darts?
What did
unquestionably,
I say? Sports.
Unquestionably.
Yeah, darts,
I mean,
his
Barry Hearn's biggest philosophy is that he can take almost any sport and make it the best that it can be.
Yeah.
And I don't even think we've reached the pinnacle with darts yet, because we still have other markets to crack.
Mm.
We still want to go to America and we want to go to China, and they're on the horizon in the next 24 months.
Yeah.
So what Barry's done is he's just turned a sport that really had the opportunity to be taken here, but it took some time. So it's taken about 10 years for it to get to this stage. So far, you know, we're looking at arenas like Leeds and the O2. They're packing those out, and now all of a sudden Alexandra Palace has got to be switched around so they can put more people in there. It's just Barry's really clever at selling things and getting the most out of the orange when you're squeezing it. And that's just the way he does it with snooker and with darts.
And believe it or not, Paul, when I was playing darts at university in Nottingham...
It was Trent Polytechnic.
Just shut up for a minute. The the pub that I used at the bottom of my road was famous in the darts world, because one of the guys who played in there had been a former News of the World champion. And in those days, if you were a News of the World champion, it was like being the world champion. I mean, that's how far it's come, you know?
Yeah, back in the late 70s when the Lakeside Championship started, and the first champion was Leighton Rees, but before that, and even a few years after that, the News of the World was renowned as the tournament to win, and probably in history the hardest one to win out of anything that's ever been. So if you know a News of the World champion, then that's one guy to know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, it was.
So, Paul, how do you get back from this terrible year? And I mean, if you don't mind me asking, what caused the terrible year? Did you just lose form? I mean, how do you get back up there to get into the competition for next year?
Yeah, it's going to be really difficult for me, because obviously this year I've had a couple of injuries. I had a problem with my neck for a couple of months earlier in the year. Then when I came back from a trip to Australia and New Zealand with the World Series of Darts, I had tendonitis in my right wrist, which is my throwing hand as well, which kept me out for about 6 to 8 weeks. So it's just, I had a good start of the season in January and February, but when these injuries came, they came at the wrong times and just really stopped my momentum. So officially now, you just sweep the rest of this year under the carpet, and then you start the year fresh in January, and just move on from there and just try and build a conference and get a little bit of momentum again.
Paul, how come you're an Australian professional darts player when you sound like you should be, you know, sitting in the Lees End at Newcastle?
God, if I had a clue for the amount of times I've been asked this.
Yeah.
But I actually was living in Australia when I broke into the professional ranks, and I was a permanent resident of Australia. And at the time, I was selected to play for Australia in the annual Tri-Nations Test match.
Wow.
So I'm a very loyal person. Earlier in my career, I played County Darts for Northumberland.
Mm.
But when Australia came knocking on the door and said, we want you to play for us,
yeah,
I said, OK, I'm going to do that for you to pay back, you know, the faith that they had in me. And then I said, OK, I'm not going to play for England because I think Australia were the first who came knocking. I'm just a very, very honest person, and I want to be faithful to the people who came knocking first.
Yeah, no, that's fair enough. We admire
but you still,
loyalty.
But you've still got loyalty to Newcastle Football Club, even though, you know, they've been through some rough times recently.
Yeah, I mean, I'm always going to be a Newcastle fan, but most important for me is the Pittsburgh Steelers do well in the NFL. I mean, that's my sport.
Well, don't get Porky started on that. Funnily enough, the Spurs stadium decision just came through tonight, so Tottenham are going to be able to build their new stadium, which will include, of course, the capability of putting on an awful lot of NFL games once it's done in a couple of years' time.
Absolutely. I mean, I hope the Steelers come over for some away games because there being a 20-year waiting list for Heinz Field in America, they're probably not going to have to do any home game switches to Spurs or to Wembley or Twickenham, but it's great that NFL games are coming over here and the opportunity for, you know, big fans over here of big sports and possibly a London franchise in the future is looking very, very likely.
No, I think you're absolutely right. Mike, why don't you tell him what you think of the NFL?
The NFL?
Yeah.
Well, it's a five-minute fad in this country, to be honest,
rubbish,
Paul. And, you know, we have bursts of enthusiasm for it in the 80s, the 90s and earlier in this century, and now it's happening again. But it'll fade out again because in the same way as we try to impose what they call soccer on the Americans, they try to impose NFL on us. It doesn't work. It's not in the psyche.
It works.
It's not in the psyche of people.
It does work.
It doesn't work. It doesn't work.
I mean, they sell out Wembley every time they have a game.
Yeah, but that's because it's a novelty.
No, it's not a novelty.
How many games at Wembley do they have a season?
Well, they're now having three a season. They're going to have four a season.
I mean, three. If they had it every week, Mike, it would be a third full.
It wouldn't be every week.
Well,
it would never be every week.
Well, if they did, it would be.
Sorry about this, Paul.
Just one last question.
He's so rude.
Sorry, Paul. One last question here. Do you think that a guy who turns up on stage like Peter Snakebite Wright, who I think is an absolute disgrace, you know, with his multicoloured hair and his tattoos and he looks like a strutting peacock, do you think he does the sport any good or do you think he damages the reputation of your sport?
I think Peter, he does appeal to a lot of different darts fans. There are a lot of purists who don't really get what Peter's doing.
Yeah.
But I think in order for Peter to be the best player that he could possibly be, he needed to find something that allowed him to turn into that more aggressive, colourful character. And as a result, it's turned him into a much better player, which for the game is very good because his standard of play in the last 2.5 years has been the best he's ever produced.
Unfortunately, though, he attracts lowlifes to the sport, doesn't he? Which otherwise wouldn't be within the sport. And I think it kind of lowers the class of darts fans.
Absolutely
really
rubbish.
I think it does. I mean, you know, I could tell, Paul, from the way we spoke to you, the manner, the way you carry yourself, your fans will be, you know, intelligent, erudite people. But I don't think you could say that about Snakebite's fans, who basically are just, you know, I don't know.
Well, it's not right to be calling yourself after, Guinness and cider, Snakebite, isn't it?
It is, Snakebite, right, yeah. Well, you know, I'm not sure about it. But anyway, every man to his own image,
well,
I suppose.
Exactly. Mm. So, Paul, so
that's
when...
That's exactly right, guys.
Forgive him, he's a terrible snob. Very elitist.
Just have my standard.
Now, Paul, tell us, when are you next playing darts? You're saying you're taking a bit of a break, so when can anyone see you playing again?
Well, over Christmas time, I'm going to have Christmas off for the first time in 7 years, so that's going to feel a little bit weird. But I'm back to trying to qualify for some of the European events in the middle of January, and there are some shows happening in 2016, exhibition-wise, and some of the TV tournaments. If you want to know any more about those, all of the information's available via Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all those kind of usual channels.
Okay.
But, yeah, I'm really looking forward to next season.
Great, brilliant. Well, we'll be tweeting out on your Twitter
we
account, so
will.
We'll make sure people can follow you on that. Paul, thanks very much indeed
for
taking the time.
Thank you, Paul. Great to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Paul Nicholson there. You're so rude to people.
Why was I rude?
You were rude. You just kept cutting across him when he was talking.
No, I didn't.
Every time I tried to ask a question, you'd shout me down.
No.
It's unbelievable.
Mike, what you've got to understand
is... there is some kind of etiquette here.
What you've got to understand is, with radio technology, is that the prime listening time for a listener is about 3.75 minutes.
Yeah, well, you use all of that up on your own.
No, until...
Yeah, you do. You use all of that up on your own.
If you stop being interesting, they decide to listen to something else. So
luckily, we don't stop being interesting.
So I have
to... make it into some kind of monologue where you just start interrupting people all the time. People get very upset.
I have to keep my ear on the interesting factor, and if I think it's waning, then it's my responsibility to get in there, you see. Yeah. Simple as that.
Okay.
Don't you understand that?
Bolo says this.
Bolo.
Mike, just to stir it up, Porky used to have his picture with Joan Collins on his wall in his non-penthouse along with Everton slippers, and he also has an extensive collection of free CDs out of the Sunday papers.
I do, actually. Mm. In fact, I've got dozens of those.
Saw an ad today for the Beatles CD, by the way.
Oh, did
you? I actually thought in a weak moment, it would be a nice thing to buy Porky for Christmas.
Well, my family are already on the case, but thank you for the thought.
Oh, well, there goes your Christmas present.
Yes.
Let's talk sport.
Christmas 2015 on Talk Sport.
Back in the net!
Pull your stockings up.
And an acorn small and round, lying on the cold, cold ground. Everyone walks over me.
A very appropriate song for you. I'm a nut.
I'm not going to rise to that stupid little jibe of yours.
Well, it's not a stupid little jibe, it's just a description.
Yeah, but
it's not my description. Some people may describe you as that.
Yeah, you're referring to me as a nut, as in the sense of somebody's unbalanced mentally.
Well, possibly so.
Yeah, I mean, your father was a nutter. I mean, I'm not a nutter.
My father suffered from dementia.
Well, no, he didn't.
Right?
Before he...
No, he suffered from dementia.
No, at the end of
his life. And
he's
now dead. So I would ask you, as many times as I've asked you in the past, to please not speak ill of the dead.
Right, your father had dementia in the last years of his life. I'm very sorry about that, and of course it's a shocking thing to happen
to a lot
of people.
You're not sorry at all.
But for most of
his
life...
You are not sorry.
For most of his life, he was an eccentric nutter who didn't have
dementia. Yeah, he was eccentric.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, you know...
I mean, you're eccentric.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm not eccentric. I don't do strange things.
Oh, you do very strange things.
I don't. You try to present me as an eccentric because you say I've locked rooms with things in them, which I don't.
Right.
Because you just portray this image.
Well, should we go through the list of things that you do that are strange?
No, because the audience
are
not interested.
What do you do when you fill up your car with petrol?
I put those cellophane gloves on, which millions of other people do because they're provided
by
a garage.
But you don't just do that, do you?
What do you mean?
You don't just do that, do you?
I keep the car clean by wiping down the areas that are affected by diesel.
Right.
Well, what's the point? What's the problem with that?
So you don't just put the gloves on and put the nozzle into the car.
I like to keep my car clean.
And then you put the nozzle back, and and then you take the gloves off, and then you go into your little car, and you open the little glove box, you take out a little wet wipe, and you wipe around the area where the petrol may have gone.
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you take some more wet wipes and wipe your hands again.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. And you don't think that's weird?
No, I don't.
Okay.
No.
And you have slippers inside the house for inside the house and outside the house. You have slippers for outside.
Yeah,
the
I do
house.
Because I think anybody.
And you don't think that's weird?
No, I don't. I think if anybody goes out walking in their slippers, you know, and says, oh, I'm just dipping around to the corner shop, they then come back into the house and bring all the filth of the pavement, all the filth and grime of the pavement into the house onto their carpets.
Right.
So I'm sorry, but they're at fault, not me.
Yeah.
I change my slippers. If I use any slippers, the only thing I use, the only time I go out of my house with my slippers on is into my roof garden.
Yeah.
And of course,
wear slippers in a roof garden?
There are particles in case I have to go out for some particular reason to, you know, attend to a plant or something like that.
Into a plot.
Yeah, really? And if there's, you know, in a roof garden that's got plants, there'll be deposits of soil and you know, birds fly overhead and all sorts of things.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to wear my indoor slippers when I do that.
Quite right.
Forget
Why don't you have a special pair of outdoor shoes?
I have got a pair of outdoor shoes as well.
Outside as well?
No, I've got a pair of outdoor shoes at the back door to go out onto the roof garden in case it's raining.
All right. Well, that's all very odd. You've also got, like, a prison door on the outside of your penthouse apartment.
No, I haven't.
Yes,
I've got a beautifully...
It's a wrought iron prison door.
No, it's a beautifully crafted iron door which has got...
nobody else has got one.
And by the way, it's white. Well, I don't care about anybody else.
Yeah.
The point is, you know,
it's
for
like
years...
It's like a drug dealer's den.
No, for years and years, I worked away from home a lot. You know, I'd be away for sometimes 6 weeks at the World Cup or something like that. Mm. So I had this gate made, which is beautifully crafted flowers in
flowers.
Yes, intrinsic
metal. It's like a
prison
door.
It's not a prison door, Mike. You see, you give this weird image of me.
And what about when you go around spraying the bottom of trees with ammonia to stop the dogs from going to do their business there?
Well, I think
that's odd.
I think that's incredibly practical.
Yeah.
Nobody wants, you know, dog dirt or dog muck on their pavement. So if you can find a way to deter the dogs from doing it, which I have done, by the way, it hasn't happened in years, then I think that's very practical.
Okay.
Now, listen, I want to talk to you about nuts
anyway. Yeah, go on then.
Because this is what it's all about.
Nutella.
Now, I've warned about nut shortages in the past,
Yeah.
But this...
And none of them proved to be correct.
Well, they were correct. It's just that times change. Mm. But this is absolute evidence. What's happening is that in California, there is a massive war going on involving nuts.
Right. A nut war.
Yeah, and it's a criminal nut war.
Is it?
Consignments of up to $500,000 of nuts are being stolen on a daily basis. Almonds, the trendy superfood...
Almonds.
Mm, almonds, the trendy superfood championed by celebrities such as Gwyneth Paltrow are at the centre of an illicit trade along with walnuts and pistachios.
Really?
There is a worldwide...
Well, pistachios are expensive, aren't they?
There's a worldwide shortage and they are being stolen in voluminous amounts.
Why?
Well, I'm telling you. Growers and processors in California have become so alarmed at the sophistication and scale of the crimes that they recently held an emergency nut theft meeting to discuss how to deal with the issue.
Who did?
The growers and processors in California of nuts, right?
Right.
The FBI, that's the Federal Bureau of Investigation, have now set up a nut bureau, right?
Don't you think they've got enough to worry about with ISIS and people having mass shootings all over the place in San Bernardino and shutting down entire school systems in Los Angeles? So now they've got a nut task force.
No, but that was a hoax.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Reacted to a hoax.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Stupid.
It doesn't matter. The point is that, you know, if they've got busy, if they've got FBI agents working or stuff like that, how can they possibly find time to look into nuts, nut hoaxes?
Let me tell you, a chap called Mike Boudreau, right?
Yeah.
Who is the sheriff.
Boudreau-Garley.
What sort of nonsense is that?
Sorry.
Right. Mike Boudreau, spelled B-O-U-D-R-E-A-U-X. That has nothing to do with Bodru, whatever you're talking about. Right? Right? You were talking about the former United Nations boss.
Yeah, the UN guy, yeah. Boutros-Ghali.
Boutros-Ghali.
It was one of the great names.
Well, anyway, this is...
The guy now has actually got quite a good name as well, hasn't he? The guy who's in charge of the UN now.
What's his name?
I can't remember.
Yeah, I can't remember.
But it's quite good.
You know, the guy who used to work in the office next to me in New York was called Skip Barnhuder.
That's brilliant.
I love Skip Barnhuder.
Yeah.
Anyway, so this guy is Mike Boudreau. He is the sheriff of Tulare County in California's Central Valley.
Yeah.
And he said the nut thefts follow surging demand for tree nuts. No, he didn't. Sorry. No, he said... sorry. He said, we have a very organised crime syndicate, almost a mafia-style setup, operating across California in the theft of nuts.
Right.
Okay? That comes from a sheriff.
Mm.
Now then... The sheriff. Yeah, the sheriff.
New sheriff in town.
New sheriff, Deputy
Banky Dorn. Moon was the guy I was thinking of.
Yeah, Banky Moon, yeah. Now, the thefts follow surging demand for tree nuts.
Yeah, but who's stealing them?
Well, this is... criminal syndicates are stealing them.
But doing what with them? You know, making cakes?
No.
What?
Selling them on to suppliers.
Selling them to who?
To suppliers.
Well, surely all they've got to do is say to these people that are buying them, don't buy, you know, stolen nuts.
Well, they don't know they're stolen, do they?
Well, they must know they're stolen.
No, they don't know they're stolen. Well, when you buy cigarettes in some little corner shop in this country, you don't know they're stolen.
Yeah, but if you're buying them as a manufacturer, then you're buying them in huge bulk, aren't you? If some guy turns up with a packet of cigarettes in a corner shop and you buy them, that's different from a guy with a lorry
load
saying, why don't you buy, like, 7,000 cigarettes?
Have you never heard of the profession of fencing?
Yeah, of course I have.
Fencing means people who get rid of stolen goods.
Yes, I
know. Well, that applies to nuts as well as it does to cigarettes and money.
But not in massive quantities.
It does. Anyway, listen.
For example, if you had a lorry load full of, like, small packets of nuts, like the ones you buy for Christmas, right?
Yes.
That would be understandable that you wouldn't necessarily know they've been stolen.
Mm.
But if these guys are selling, you know, literally giant tons and tons of pistachios...
Yeah.
Surely you'd say, well, where'd you get these from?
No, because those tons and tons of pistachios are being distributed amongst probably 2,000 retailers.
I'll tell you why, because people are basically dishonest.
Well, you're absolutely right.
People will try and get a break and try and get something on the cheap if they can.
But this is such an interesting story. It says the thefts follow surging demand for tree nuts. Prices for walnuts, almonds and pistachios have more than doubled since 2010.
Right.
And production has had to soar to keep up with demand.
Mm.
Demand is being driven by the growing middle classes in China and India. So a lot of these nuts are being stolen and shipped out to China.
Ah, well, that's a different story. You didn't tell me that.
No, hang on. This is the sheriff again. He's saying, here in the States, more people are including nuts into their diet for health reasons.
Yeah.
These are very valuable crops. And there's a guy called Roger Ison.
Roger Ison.
Ison, I-S-O-M.
Sounds like Rogerization.
It does, just like Rogerization. No, his name, honestly, is Roger Isom, I-S-O-M, Rogerization,
So he's got his brother Bladder there with him as well.
Yeah, that's right, Bladderization, So Roger Isom, who's president of the Western Agricultural Processors Association, Well, I mean, that's a complete coincidence, by the way. We'll be sorry about that.
Yeah, I know.
So one name I picked out, Roger Isom.
We must get him on the show.
Yeah, president of the Western Agricultural Processors Association,
yeah,
California-based trade group,
yeah,
representing the tree, nut and processing industry, said most of the stolen nuts are exported.
Well, why don't they get some armed guards to stop getting stolen? You know, if you keep getting ripped off all the time, surely what you do, especially in America, is you get a couple of guys with some rifles and you don't get stuff stolen from you anymore.
Mr. Isom, of Roger that is, one shipment was intercepted after being loaded onto a ship in Los Angeles which was destined for Saudi Arabia.
Wow.
I mean, it's a big business.
It sounds like a big business. Yeah. But are you saying that this is going to affect the availability of pistachios and almonds and walnuts in this country?
I am indeed.
Wow.
In one theft in Tulare County, where Sheriff Boudreau
rules.
Why is
he talking about this guy like he's some kind of Wild West kind of maniac?
Well, they're like that out there, aren't they?
No, obviously not.
In one theft in Tulare County last month, pistachios worth $500,000 were stolen. They had all the right documents. Scott Woodard... Sorry, what's funny about that? That's his name.
That's not his name.
It is.
Scott Woodard.
Woodard. Scott Woodard. Who's the controller? Guess what his job is?
I have no idea.
He is...
Nut filterer.
No, he is literally... His title on the Scott is Controller Horizon Nut Company.
Has it got a P? Yeah, they have comptrollers they have there, don't they?
No.
With a P.
No, honestly.
Oh, God, we got to go.
Scott Woodard, controller, Horizon Nut Company, told ABC News, "We had no idea, really, that anything was out of the ordinary at all until our nuts disappeared." Dear. Yeah.
Dear God. Right. Yeah. We'll have to examine this one further. Obviously, there's a lot of people with weird names, and it's a nut conspiracy going on.
Apparently, Armenians are organising it all.
The Armenians?
It's a bunch of Armenian gangsters.
I think that's very unfair.
No, it is. Armenian gangsters are responsible.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics, although for the moment there's only one of us here, because I'm not quite sure what's going to happen to Porky. I think he's gone off for another can of Red Bull. He'll be back in a moment. Let me read you a couple of tweets in the meantime. Here's one from Roderick in Inverurie. He says, "Mike, that will be the FNBI, Federal Nut Bureau of Investigation. Anybody wants to steal things like that has to be nuts." And then he says, "Good show, folks." Dylan has actually found the man Roger Isom. He's on Twitter, apparently.
Oh, is he?
So maybe we should tweet him and see if he wants to come on the show.
Yeah.
And he can tell us about what's going on within the nut conspiracy.
Exactly.
Which is fascinating.
It certainly is. And thanks for all the messages, including one from Hobbits Recovering. This is Becky again, right?
Yeah.
Do you know she's found that... because she regards us as the decadent rich from the Northern Hemisphere...
Oh, yeah.
A bottle of freeze-dried champagne that you can use as garnish for your chips instead of vinegar.
Freeze-dried champagne?
Yeah.
What's that all about?
I don't know. But she says it's garnish for chips. And
well, surely if it's freeze-dried champagne, at some point you defrost it, don't you?
Well, I suppose so, but then...
You're not very good at that, though, are you?
No.
Defrosting things.
No, I'm not. No, I'm certainly not.
That's a fridge,
no.
By the way.
Oh, don't ask. Now, listen, as we were talking about nuts, it's time for me to say a big thank you to Jennifer.
Jennifer.
Who is from West Glamorgan.
Yes.
Because she has sent me a wonderful present for Christmas. Thank you very much indeed.
She sent me a lovely present as well, actually.
Aware of the Ferrero Rocher shortage of a couple of years
ago. Did you hear what I just said?
Yes, I know, but I haven't finished telling you about what Jennifer
sent us both a present.
Yes, but my present was more important.
Why?
Well, because...
Why are they not equally important?
Well, because...
It's typical of you.
No.
Why is your present any more important than mine?
Because I'm talking about my present.
Jennifer's
at the
been listening to me on the radio for a very, very long time.
Yes, I know, and me as well.
Not you.
So don't worry about
not
that.
Not so
right?
much.
Now, what I was going to say was, she sent me Ferrero Rocher, thank you very much indeed, because I alerted the world to the Ferrero Rocher shortage of a Ferrero Rocher.
Yeah, except
Rocher
that wasn't true either.
A couple of years ago. It was, but and as a result, it was rectified very, very quickly. They went out and found... What sort of nuts do they put in the Ferrero Rocher?
Well, did we not work out there were hazelnuts?
Hazelnuts, that's right. Yeah, they found some more hazelnuts and they restocked them. And I think the latest picture we have, very attractive picture it was too, was young Emma posing with a few boxes of the old Ferrero Rocher.
At Stansted Airport,
Airport,
en route to Glasgow.
Indeed.
Yeah, well, we've got loads and loads of tweets and texts to read out. Here's one from somebody, James in York, who says it's a squirrel mafia. Obviously. Then here's one from Pete who says, Roger Isom, he says, "I parked up in my 44 tonner not far from you near the Borough Station.
You
guys cracked me up, and I've seen a few of his brothers bladdered on my drive down from Northampton tonight."
I bet you have indeed.
TNT, T. Pete.
I didn't know you could park near Borough Station in London. It's a very built-up area.
Well, yeah, but, I mean, the trouble is now, with the way the roads are, and, I mean, I'm sorry to have to go on about them again, but, I mean, lately, in the last few days, it's actually got
outrageous.
Even worse. You know, there is now...
outrageous.
The traffic was at a standstill this morning at 4 a.m.
4 a.m.
As Sandy Waugh came
in. Sandy, our newsreader, came in, and I was going out the front door. She was coming in at about 20 past four, and she actually said, I can't believe we've been stuck in a traffic jam at the top of the road for 10 minutes. And
I know.
This is a street called Stamford Street, which is the main artery in London.
Artery in
London between Waterloo Station and Blackfriars Bridge, going all the way up to London Bridge Station.
Yeah.
And it is a vital road. Yeah. It's a vital road of communication from one side of the river to the other.
Yeah.
And it is completely clogged up.
I mentioned this to you yesterday, and it remains to be seen whether or not I will eventually get some kind of ticket for it.
Yeah.
But I got so frustrated trying to get around all of these ridiculous traffic jams but I didn't say it on the radio, I don't think. That I ended up going up through a no-entry sign.
Right.
It's the only way I'm going to get to work.
Well,
shocking state of affairs.
I mean, don't you remember a few months ago, they actually started digging our road up for reasons we've never found out.
Yeah, it was shut for... they built a little
ramp. Chicane.
Built a ramp.
A ramp and a chicane to try and slow traffic down in a road where there was no traffic until they decided to divert it all here.
Mm.
And every night when I came in and couldn't get up here, I went through a no-entry sign, but it was only for a space, I would say, of approximately 20 yards.
Yeah.
But that 20 yards allowed me to short-circuit my journey by 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And so I did it, and I didn't care if I got a ticket
it remains to be seen, as I say, whether that happens. Now, I've got something to say to you, because earlier on in the show, and I've got a couple of people referring to what you said about my father once again.
Mm-hmm.
People have said they wouldn't be surprised if I lamp you one one of these nights.
Yeah.
But you said sorry, right?
Yes.
And you said it in such a way that I detected that it was a very insincere apology.
Well, I'll say it again if you want.
No,
sincerely.
No, because I read a piece yesterday in The Independent, which basically is a guide to when the times are that you should never say sorry.
Right.
And I would accuse you of basically saying these times. When you say sorry, these are things that you've done all the time, all through your life, right? Because number one is when you really aren't sorry, right? It says, we've all witnessed the classic non-apology where someone thinks they've said they're sorry, but they really haven't.
Mm.
Right?
Well, Tony Blair is guilty of that.
Well, you're guilty of it.
No, I'm not.
Leave it for when you are genuinely sorry and you actually want to convey ownership of an issue. Don't just say sorry when obviously everybody realises that...
What kind of mumbo-jumbo is that?
Because it's insincere.
No.
Right?
I said sorry because I wanted to differentiate completely between the period of your father's life when he was genuinely ill with dementia, which came in the last years of his life, and most of the rest of his life when I knew him, when he didn't have dementia, he was an eccentric.
There's nothing wrong with being eccentric.
This is a guy, right?
There's nothing wrong with being an eccentric.
I went around to your house once.
This is not about my father. This is about you.
Hang on.
This is about your inability to understand sensitivity and issues which people get upset about.
I go around to your parents' house once, right?
Yeah.
And your father never drove, did he?
He took his driving test once and failed.
Right. Well, there you go.
And then never took it again.
So I went around to your house.
He claimed he was a navigator.
After I think we'd been in New York together or something. He said he was having a new art exhibition, but he had a problem getting all his exhibits. From
his paintings,
from his house.
Of which you bought a few.
Yeah, to the gallery.
Which you've now stuffed in some rented accommodation, right?
To the gallery, yeah. So what we do is we loaded my car up, the boot, the back seat, everything, only left room for him in the passenger seat. We put some on the roof and everything, I mean, and got all these exhibits. Took 2 hours, and we drove round to the gallery.
Mm.
The gallery had closed down. There was no gallery.
No, was it not that it was shut that day?
It had closed down.
Well, it hadn't closed down completely.
It had. It closed down.
No, I think you're embellishing the story.
Hang on. It had either closed down for the summer or it had closed down for the winter or something.
No,
or
I think
whatever.
It closed down for the day.
No, believe me. There was nothing in there. We looked and he said, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, and he didn't.
Right.
So then we had to go back to the house and unload all the stuff for another two hours. Now, that I'm sorry.
Well, maybe he just wanted to give you something to do.
That is the.
See, you're not sorry. You've done it again.
No,
you've said it again. You've just done it. You've just done it. Now, here again, here's another one. When you use it as a get out of jail free card, right?
Oh, yeah.
If a person uses a phrase such as, I'm sorry, but I just wasn't able to finish it on time, thinking that you're sorry basically abdicates all responsibility, which is what you do as well. You think by saying sorry that people will forgive you.
Mm.
Here's another one. When you automatically assume it will lead to forgiveness, right?
Mm-hmm.
Saying you're sorry is only part of the process, and depending on the context, the person you're apologising to may not be ready to forgive you or feel that it's warranted.
Yeah.
And that's another one that you do.
Seem to have gone into this quite a lot. Do you have a huge catalogue of things that you feel you should have said said sorry for?
No, I don't feel so sorry for anything. You know, if I need to apologise for something, something that I've done, I say sorry in a very meaningful and sincere way.
Yeah.
You know, but what I don't do is what you do, which is to be completely insincere and just go, oh, sorry, I called you dad a nutter.
Yeah.
You're not sorry at all, are you?
Yes, I am, because I don't want people to think I'm being unkind to a man who clearly had mental health issues towards the end of his life.
Here's another one, right?
He didn't.
See, this is the other way you do it, because in all intents and purposes, you're a bit of a coward, right? Mm. When you're having a passionate debate over something and disagreeing with someone, you feel inclined to use the words, I'm sorry, because you think that it might soften the conflict. Because when you get a bit worried that I might actually lamp you at some point, then you make out like you didn't mean to say it.
People say sorry sometimes when they know that they've committed an error which is going to affect their career, their personal relationships, their financial well-being. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to do that. I'm really sorry this. I'm really sorry that.
Right.
People who say really sorry are more culpable than people who say sorry.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing
is...
What
about before you ask a favour of someone? Have you ever said this? I'm sorry, but would you mind helping me? I bet you have.
Only if I'm annoyed with somebody, because they're acting in an inappropriate manner.
So you've done all of these things that people say you shouldn't do.
I mean, you say sometimes to somebody, for emphasis, well, I'm really sorry, but would you F off, right, don't you?
Well, I've never said that to anyone.
Well, I do.
Well, you see, that you shouldn't say.
No,
because you're not sorry.
No, I'm not.
No. So why say the words?
Because I'm mocking them by saying, you know, I'm pretending that I'm
so
sorry
rude.
In using an expletive towards you, but I'm not really.
No.
I just want you to
That's
F
what
on,
I mean.
You know? Yeah.
So that's what I mean. So you're misusing the word and thereby creating yourself as this kind of very insincere figure so that when you actually ever do use the word sorry, nobody believes you.
Do you know what I feel is the very worst with this word sorry, right? Now, you read all these interviews every week from, you know, celebrities and all that and questions, you know, like, oh, you know, have you got any advice for, you know, children and all that, and what was the biggest thing that changed your life and career and all that? And then there's always a question which says, who is the one person you want to say sorry to or the one thing you want to apologise for?
Yes.
And the one stock answer, which always makes me think that person is a vile individual, is the answer, I don't do sorry.
Yeah, right? That is awful, isn't it?
I mean, there was one. There's one
because,
female.
I mean, it's one way of saying, like, je ne regrette rien.
Yeah, that's
which
right.
Means I feel no regrets.
Yeah,
about anything,
that's right. You know, laissez-faire and all
it?
That
yeah.
is different.
Yeah.
But this, I don't do sorry.
Yeah.
And to me, that is appalling because, and the one I'm thinking about most recently was a female media person.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know, and it was, you know, I don't do sorry. And, you know,
I wonder who that could be.
Yeah, exactly. And I thought, and I tell
so
you what,
our first name's not Janet, is it?
Well, I can't possibly get into that. And
the time, by the way.
I remember one night.
Sorry, but I'm going to have to ask you to stop talking.
The International Press Centre in Shoe Lane, right.
Yeah.
I got completely bladdered. And I went back the next day and I said to the chief barman, because we were there till 4 a.m.
It was like a private club then, wasn't it?
I said, look, I'm really very, very sorry last night. I stayed too long. I was rude to some of your guests. You know, I fell down the stairs and I damaged that table.
Yeah, because the lift only went up to the
bottom
of the stairs,
exactly,
didn't it?
Exactly, yeah, and all that kind of stuff, you know. And he said, that's all right, mate, don't worry. I went back to the office, and one arrogant individual there said, where have you been? And I said, I just went over the press centre, I had to apologise. And he said, you mad? You never say sorry when you're intoxicated, pal. You just pretend it didn't happen and you get away with it. And I thought, no, you don't. If you've done wrong, you're going to say sorry.
You're saying somebody in the Express had worse morals than you?
Yeah, worse, much
Blimey.
Worse.
That's
much
extraordinary.
Worse.
This is Talk Sport, loads more coming up.
Colin Murray, weekday mornings from 10 on TalkSport with Wix. Every weekday morning, get opinionated comment.
So excited, only 3 Leeds United managers until Christmas.
Exclusive interviews.
Jimmy Carragher.
Well, I had him by the throat, never mind shouting at him. Yeah.
An unmissable debate.
You've backed yourself into a wall now, Cole, if you don't mind me saying so.
From the biggest names in sports broadcasting every day.
As always, you take this show on to a new level.
There ain't no listeners like the TalkSport listeners.
Colin Murray, weekday mornings from 10 on TalkSport with Wix. Let's do it right.
I know. The state pension is changing.
I know. How much you get will still depend on your national insurance record. And don't forget you may still have a private pension to consider too.
I know. I'll be able to see how much I'm likely to receive and understand what I can do to improve my state pension.
I know. If you reach state pension age on or after the 6th of April 2016, you'll be part of the new scheme.
Make sure you know the facts about the new state pension. Visit gov.uk/yourstatepension for more information.
Driving experiences at Mercedes-Benz World are the perfect Christmas gift. From under 17s driving to 4x4 and high-performance AMG experiences on our handling circuits, there's something for everyone. Prices start at just £45. Call 0370 400 4000 or visit mercedes-benzworld.co.uk to buy yours today. Mercedes-Benz World at Brooklands, just off Junction 10 on the M25.
If you fancy a flutter on the football, a gamble on the golf, a double on the darts, or a treble on the tennis, you're in luck. Get closer to the action every weekend with Betway's Man in the Know on the Weekend Sports Breakfast with Georgie Bingham and Mickey Quinn. Bringing you all the form on the football, the going at Goodwood, the tries at Twickenham, and the overs at the Oval. Every Saturday and Sunday morning from 7 on TalkSport. With Betway. For the latest offers, head to betway.com.
Adrian Durham and Darren Goff.
50p boxes of mixed biscuits.
This afternoon from 4.
Your autobiography is brilliant.
I love dipping in tea.
Superb. Yeah.
Talk Sport.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics. It's Porkyvision coming up a little bit later on. Tomorrow, of course, is the Porky quiz on the US space program.
Yes, space program.
Which I believe the independent quizmasters are already working on.
Yes, indeed. Yeah,
it's
that's
quite
great.
A big area, that. Now, let me read you a few more tweets and texts. Here's one from Marvelous, he calls himself.
Marvelous.
My mum is in Trinidad for Christmas and has told me she has seen Ferrero Rocher priced at $250, which is for something that's cost about £24 here.
Crikey.
No, sorry, £24 here. Yeah. Total rip-off.
Why don't we get a case full of them, get over to Trinidad, quick, make a few thousand and come back?
Because I don't do that sort of thing.
I would think
about
it.
I'm not a fence.
It's called entrepreneurial.
No, it is not.
Yeah.
Simon in Sheffield said, roadworks, what about the trains from Heathrow and Gatwick over Christmas suspended? Well,
That's a scandal.
Now, you were telling me this the other day, that they're going to suspend all these roadworks because they're going to help people to get around over Christmas, right? Now, one, I didn't believe that story because I thought to myself, this is partly about guys not wanting to work over Christmas so they could just, you know, leave. But I bet you what they don't do is put all the roads back the way they were. They'll still have all the cones there and
Maybe, all the things lined up.
But we're now here, right? Do you remember I said, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, I saw a sign at London Bridge Station saying between Christmas Eve, 24th of December and January the 4th, no trains will stop here or at Waterloo East or at Charing Cross, I think.
Yeah.
So now it turns out if you land at Heathrow or Gatwick, you can't get a train into London.
I mean, I think it's an utter
for
disgrace.
Like 10 days.
I think it's a scandal. And I think Mr. Cameron, it's another, you know, huge, massive error of policy from his government.
How can they let this happen?
If you land in this country over Christmas, coming to see your family and all that kind of stuff, and you're literally standing around at Heathrow with six suitcases and you've got nowhere to go except an £80 taxi into London.
Or schlepping all the stuff down to the underground and trying to get on that, which takes
about an hour and a half.
It's an
absolute damn disgrace.
Town.
And by the way, nobody's announced it. This was a story which I think broke on the front of the Independent yesterday morning, written by Britain's top tourist and travel correspondent, Simon Calder.
Oh, yeah.
Who I think must have come on to one of the shows yesterday.
We've had him on a few times, Simon.
He's a great guy. And it was Bild exclusive, and it actually said, for 10 days, there will be no... I mean, what are they going to do in those 10 days? Yeah. Tell me what they're doing.
I mean, because from Heathrow, at least you do have the option of the tube.
Yes.
But from Gatwick, you've got no option.
You've got no option whatsoever. And I tell you what, mate, that is stuck down in Sussex in the middle of a field, basically, Gatwick. And you're only...
Well, the train service is very good. I mean, if it's not working, there's no other way to get in.
Well, no, the Gatwick Express is very good, but there are other trains which stop at, like, 12 stations Gatwick and...
Well, the Brighton train stops there and, you know, stops there sort of with very few stops.
Yeah,
but the point is, with no trains at all, you know, how are you supposed to get in? There'll be coaches.
No, but those trains will still run, won't they?
No.
You sure?
No.
You're absolutely sure? The Brighton train won't be running?
No.
Nobody can go to Brighton for 10 days,
either. As far as I know, there are no trains coming from Gatwick at all.
I think it's the expresses, to be honest, but we'll have to look at the story and find out what the definitive
is. Even if they are running, they're not stopping at London Bridge, which is where they would normally stop in London.
It's a disgrace.
And I don't know where they're going.
Listen, we're talking about you're talking about the word sorry, OK?
Yeah.
So I've done some research here. Now, on-trend office lingo.
Yeah.
Right?
On-trend office lingo.
Yeah.
Because you're right up to the minute on this, aren't
you? Yes, I am, Beloved by bosses.
This is the man who calls, what is it you call people? Kids? Is that you refer to them?
Folks.
Whenever you do a live show, you call folks, kids.
Hi, folks. Hi, kids.
Kids.
Yeah. What's wrong with that?
Baby.
Yeah. But anyway, the ones...
Baby.
Look, if somebody...
Babe.
Yeah, why not babe? What's wrong with babe?
Babe is sexist.
I think babe is very affectionate.
Well, you wouldn't call me babe, would you?
No, of course I wouldn't. You're a man.
Yeah, exactly.
But I would call... look, I've got lady friends.
Yeah, you call them babe.
Hello, babe. Yeah, I do.
You can't do that in the office.
Why not?
Because it's sexist.
The woman does not object. It's not sexist.
How do you know that?
I ask her.
Would you call any woman that you didn't know in the office babe?
No.
So it's a deliberate name for somebody that you know?
Yes.
That you are familiar with?
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
So I don't think that's too bad at all.
What about darling?
No. I sometimes say, hello, my love, how are you?
My love.
What's wrong with that?
That's also sexist.
It's not sexist.
You say that to men?
It's not. No, I don't. It's friendly.
Well, then it's sexist.
It's not sexist.
Something which is sexist is something that you only say to one sex.
Okay, so if there was a girl and I said, hello, my girl, is that sexist?
Yes.
Why? Because I don't say it to a man.
Yeah.
If I said it to a man, it's an inaccurate description.
She's not your girl.
It's an inaccurate description of the person, because the person is not a girl, the person's a man or a boy.
How about you just say hello? Or call them by their name.
Because I like being friendly.
No,
anyway,
but you don't remember anybody's name.
Let me get back to the lingo thing, okay?
Go on, then.
Right, the worst ones, blue sky thinking.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
Well, none of these things mean anything.
We used to have a boss here, used all these stupid expressions.
Well, yeah, I used to sit in meetings and hear people...
Exactly.
Plough out all this claptrap.
Yeah, game changer, we've all heard... The game changer, you know.
Yeah.
The deal breaker, the game changer. Mm. But I haven't heard this one, touch base offline. What is
that? Presumably that means that, you know, basically you get in touch outside of the office, I presume that's
is
what
that
it
right?
means.
Yeah. Touch base offline?
Yeah, I presume so.
Is it? Is that what it means?
Yeah.
Thinking outside the box?
Yeah.
I mean, these are dreadful.
Mm.
This is another one I hadn't heard. But
what about does it wash its own face?
Does it wash its own face? I love that, yeah. But what about this one? Use the strategic staircase.
Yeah, I don't know what that
is. Use the strategic staircase.
What does that mean?
I've no idea.
Mm.
Sounds
rude.
What's the other one? Oh, yeah, these other ones, which are so dreadful, you feel like stuffing them back down people's throats.
Yeah.
It's not rocket science.
Yeah, I mean, that has become so ridiculous. You now hear everyone saying that.
Yeah.
I mean, even on football shows, they're all saying it.
Yeah,
it's not
right.
rocket science.
Yeah, that's right.
Know.
Yeah. And this is the other great one, which I hate as well. Let's run this up the flagpole.
Yeah.
Run it up the flagpole.
You know, that one's very old, because you know when I first heard that one or witnessed it being said?
Hornblower?
No.
Yeah?
Hornblower?
That's where it came from. It's a naval expression.
Well, run it up the flagpole and see if somebody salutes it.
No.
You run
it up the flagpole and you're sending a message with the flag at the top, you see.
No. Well, the advertising term came up.
Yeah.
It was in the 50s.
Right.
Because I'll tell you when I saw it. It was in
Mad
Men? 12 Angry Men.
12 Angry Men.
You know that movie?
Really? Yeah, yeah.
About the jury room,
yes.
Which is fantastic.
Yes.
With Henry Fonda and all that crap.
Yes, that's right.
Fantastic film. I watched it again just the other night, actually.
Did you? Okay.
Yeah. And there's a guy in that who's meant to be this kind of slick Madison Avenue guy.
Okay.
And he comes out with it first.
Yes.
Let's run this up the flagpole, see if anyone salutes it.
Really?
And everybody goes, what do you mean by that?
Yeah.
And he explains.
Yeah.
I think that's where it came from. I don't think it's anything to do with Hornblower.
It is. That's where
rubbish.
Of course, it's. Where do you find flagpoles?
What?
Where do you find flagpoles?
Well, you find them in many places.
Yeah, but you find them on ships as well.
Well, not necessarily.
Every ship's got a flagpole. It's got a mast with a flagpole.
Lots of buildings have got flagpoles.
Yeah, but I mean, they're just ceremonial flagpoles. A ship has a flagpole to put flags on communicate with other ships.
There's a flagpole on Buckingham Palace, which tells you whether the Queen's there or not.
Exactly.
Or at least it used to before the terrorism attacks.
But, you know, what I'm saying is, before shortwave radio and before radio and before even, what do they call those lights that they flash? Seismic lights or something? What are they called? What do they call?
You were like Toc H lamps.
No, what are they called?
You're talking about Morse code.
Yeah, they flash lamps, don't they? And all that. Before they had all that,
seismic lamps.
Yeah,
yeah.
In fact,
I think that's it.
In fact, the most famous military instruction ever.
Yeah.
Which was run up the flagpole was the one by Horatio Admiral Lord Nelson.
Yeah.
Which was. Every English man must today do his duty.
Yeah.
And it was misspelt.
Uh-huh.
And it came out wrong.
Yeah, what did it say instead?
It should have said, must do his... I don't know. I can't
must
remember.
But
it was a wrong one. And I used to know it, but I'll think of it. Anyway, the point is that a report has been issued about all this stupid... we used to have a boss, didn't we? We used all those expressions. Mm. You know, run up the flagpole.
Well, they all do. And now moving forward and all that nonsense.
Push the envelope, was it?
Yeah, yeah. Push the envelope. Yeah.
The one that used to drive me nuts. This guy walked in as a new boss and all that, you know, and then I went to see him. And I was a boss as well. But he said, now, have we considered the issues? It was the first time I'd ever heard this expression.
Right.
I said, I'm sorry, what?
Right.
Issues of what? Mm. Issues of a newspaper? Issues of...
Right.
No, the issues. Yeah. Have we got the issues?
Right.
I said, what are you talking about? He said, we have to address, you know... I said, are you talking about problems?
Mm.
Yeah, problems. I said, well, can we call them problems then, please? Not issues.
Yeah.
What are issues, you know?
You obviously have an issue with this.
The other one is every lorry you overtake now on the M1 or the M6 says something, something, solutions.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? If there are plumbers, yeah. It's, you know, heating and drainage solutions.
Yeah, yeah.
It used to be called plumbers.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, because it makes it sound like they know
exactly.
what they're doing.
Exactly, exactly, yeah.
It's all just nonsense, really, isn't it? Mm. Anyway, we've got lots more tweets and texts to read out, so we should do some of those coming up next on TalkSport.
Get in the ring this Saturday night from 9 as the gloves come off for a fast-paced throwdown on TalkSport. Join Danny, King of the Ring Kelly, for a season ticket Fight Club special featuring reaction to the day's biggest games with all the build-up ahead of the main event. Andy Lee goes head-to-head with Billy Joe Saunders to defend his WBO middleweight belt live in Manchester. Ron McIntosh and Glenn McCrory will be going the distance, bringing you live ringside commentary of the entire fight.
A sensational opening round.
The season ticket, Fight Club special. Andy Lee versus Billy Joe Saunders, live. Saturday night from 9 on TalkSport.
TalkSport, we are the two mics, and of course it's Porkyvision coming up a little bit later on.
Yes.
Which a lot of people have been defending today, actually, on Twitter. Because I said yesterday that there were some people who were asking them to be pulled from the schedule, saying that, you know, they felt that you weren't doing enough work
on
it.
Well, I'm sorry.
An awful lot of people jumped to your defence today.
It's a science. It's a science. Yeah. And what I explained was, I said to listen to Porkyvision properly, just turn...
What did you call it?
Sorry?
What did you call it?
Porkyvision.
Oh, I thought you said Talkyvision.
No, to listen to...
I'm sure you said Talkyvision.
No, to listen to Porkyvision
properly. I
like
the sound of that better.
No.
Talkyvision.
No, you've got to turn your ear 90 degrees, OK? And then you'll understand what I'm getting at. Right?
Okay. All right.
Right, now then, I've got some great messages here, so I'm going to read a few out, because
yeah,
you always are. Right. Steve T says, do you think that people who work at NASA use the term, it's not rocket science? Well, that's a good one. That's,
I bet they do, actually.
Yeah, they probably do. Mm. Now then, there's one here which shows a picture of an adorable little girl grimacing, and the caption to it is... my wee lassie's face when she looked at the front of the Two Mics DVD.
Yeah.
Seeing Porky's ugly mug put her off. Well, actually, your mug is far more prominent on the sleeve of Two Mics than mine.
But it's generally
accepted.
Because
you stuck your face in front of mine to try and make out you were more important
than me. I was taking a selfie and you happened to crowd into the back of the picture.
No,
what happened.
No, you wanted to make out that you're the big guy. I've got your measure.
Well, I am the big guy.
I've got, yeah, well,
and
you're
also
a big
I'm
fat
generally,
guy.
Generally accepted as a better looking man than you.
I'm more intelligent man than you.
I know there's not a lot in it. How about this from Lord Rallo?
Yeah.
I don't think anyone would blame you, MG, if you popped Porky one good time. Next time, he ridicules your father.
No.
Hashtag plank.
I don't ridicule your
Roy
father.
Roy says, I wouldn't say Porky's eccentric. Mm. I would say he's neurotic, narcissistic and a pathological liar. But we love him.
That's a very harsh. Now, Horatio here says, now, I don't quite get this. You're going to have to explain this to me, Mike. Mr. Parry is getting very close to the knuckle today. The tension is unbearable.
Really?
If he's gripping radio.
Really?
What am I getting close to the knuckle
about?
Well,
maybe he feels that you're just being a bit too rude to me. Because, I mean, people do complain about that.
Do you think because I used the expression, I'm sorry, but won't you F off? I might have been a bit near the knuckle.
Could be.
If so, I want
Could
to apologise for that, please.
You see, you're not sorry for that either, though, are you?
Yeah, I am, yeah.
No, you're not. Rubbish.
Now, here, here's another great one here.
Mm.
Right, this is from Thomas. You two guys crack me up. Mike Graham, you've got a great laugh. Great story about the nuts.
Yeah.
Well, you know...
Well, what have I told you about reading out things that just make us sound like we're bigging ourselves up?
No, we're
You're always reading out those.
No. Well,
I feel uncomfortable with that.
Hang on. If somebody is good enough to send us a message,
then
in my view, the fact that it says something nice about us does not preclude it being read out.
Well, I think it sounds a little bit sort of like you're
stroking
your own ego.
We are a two-way medium, and if
By the way...
good enough to send a message,
way,
I think
realized,
it deserves an
I've just realised,
yeah.
speaking of that, and many
yes.
people this year, mm. for some reason, have mm. decided to send us gifts. And Jennifer, that we were talking about
yes.
earlier, I completely forgot to thank her because you steamrolled it over it
and told me
that yours was a much more important gift.
Well, it is.
She sent me actually a larger box of chocolates,
yes.
Which are all liqueurs.
Oh, well, she's actually...
So thank you, Jennifer, for that. It's very kind of you.
She put a message in mine to say, I was thinking of sending you liqueurs, but I didn't want you to get drunk, so I sent you the Ferrero Rocher.
Very sensible.
So she clearly doesn't mind about you getting drunk because you're not as important.
Well, I can handle it
to
better.
The show. As
I can
I
handle
am.
It better.
Now then,
Tom says, "Okay, Porky, if you insist that you are not eccentric, then I'm afraid I'm going to say you're a nutter."
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I don't think I am.
Mm.
Now then, there's one here. It says, "No, that's a crazy one." What is the one I was looking for? Here we go. No, I haven't got it. I can't find it. Right.
So shall I read some while
yes,
you
please.
Try and find something?
Yes, please.
Scouser says this, Mr. Parry. I think I've located the stolen nuts. They're in Leicester at the KP Stadium.
KP nuts, yeah, I like it very much.
How slow are you?
Yeah,
here's one from Kenny, who says, Porky Vision has a cult following, but not the MG cult. And it says hashtag save Porkyvision.
So it's a different call. Right, I've got one here from Mickey. He says, hi, guys, I've heard a rumour that you two are moving to daytime show. If so, when and what time? Well, just to remind you guys, we are doing daytime radio between Monday, the 28th of December, and New Year's Day, I think, isn't it? New Year's Day, which is the Friday.
It's the Friday,
We'll be on at 10 to 1 on the Monday. Delighted to be in that mid-morning slot. And then for the rest of the week, absolutely glorious to be filling in for our very good mates, Paul and Andy, Hawksby and Jacobs, for that week. So we're looking forward to it.
Are you going to keep going on about this now? Between now and then?
People are asking, Mike, and if people ask, I think they deserve an answer. Okay. It's quite as simple as that,
right.
Okay?
Here's one from Def. He says, my supplier, I will call him KP, isn't returning my calls. I think he's got into his shell. This is nuts.
This is nuts. I like that. Actually, KP nuts are the only nuts I like. They're the ones that I smuggle into pubs when they sell me other horrible nuts, which I don't like.
Yeah. Have you noticed in pubs lately, by the way, that it's very difficult to buy just ordinary nuts now? It's very hard to get just ordinary salted peanuts because they want to give you all sorts of, ridiculously...
Out of a jar?
No, not out of a jar necessarily, but they're all different flavours. It's like when you go to some pubs and you want some cheese and onion crisps, and they haven't got any cheese and onion crisps. But all they've got is like cracked pepper and sea salt.
Or ham and mustard.
Yeah, or something. Yeah, which is okay, but it's all a bit over the top, isn't it?
I totally agree. But do you know what I've found lately? And I'm going to investigate this more. I have found that my KP nuts have got less salt in them than they used to have.
Yeah.
Or at least the two packets I had lately.
Why is that?
Well, I hope it's not a health thing. I hope not saying...
You think they've been forced to put less salt in
them? Well, I don't know. Now, I can't make any accusations here because I haven't studied it properly. But the reason I eat KP nuts with beer is because of the chemical reaction between alcohol and salt.
Yeah.
It's nothing to do with the nut itself.
Right.
It's the salt on the nut.
Yeah.
Because...
So you have to be careful about your salt intake, though.
Yeah, I do. I have to be very careful. Mm. And in fact, funny enough, I was with Monsieur Brazil today.
Were you?
Doing a bit of a job this morning. Yeah, it was very, very good. And
Do you not sleep at all on a Wednesday?
Not much, to be honest. I haven't had sleep today.
Because you were here, till four, and then you were back on the sports breakfast.
Yes, I was,
after you'd gone out for breakfast.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you were doing another job with him.
Well, funny enough, I just nipped home, then had a shower and came out again. And Al and I were working till about 2 o'clock.
Right.
And then we went for a bit of lunch, right?
Yeah.
And the funny thing is, you're quite right, it's to do with the salt. So before we had lunch, we asked for two of those little wire baskets of chips.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Because I hadn't had anything to eat, had any breakfast. What do you mean?
You mean crisps?
No. Chips as in fish and chips. Yeah, French fries.
Before you had lunch, you had some chips?
Yes, we had nibbles. And
that's
chips.
Not a nibble, that's like a course.
No, it's not. No, it's
what did you have for lunch after that?
Lunch after that was...
You didn't have anything else, did you?
No, I did. I had a ploughman's sandwich type thing.
A ploughman's sandwich type thing?
Yeah,
what do you mean, a ploughman's lunch?
Yes, that's right. Yeah, that sort of thing,
And cheddar?
Cheddar, chutney,
Pickled onion?
No, I don't eat pickled onions. Don't like onions.
You don't like onions?
No, I don't like onions, no.
Well, how can you cook spaghetti bolognese if you don't like onions?
I don't put onions in it. That's
you
horrible.
Don't put onions in spaghetti bolognese?
Of course I don't.
What do you put in it?
Meat. Mince. What's your problem? Mince and tomatoes.
That's it.
Yeah, that's
right. No garlic.
No, I hate garlic.
No vegetables of any kind.
Mince, tomatoes and mushrooms, right? And that's all you need.
Mushrooms?
Yeah, mushrooms, yeah. I like mushrooms, yeah.
But you need the onion for the flavour.
Hey?
Surely you put the onion in for the
flavour. I can't stand garlic. And anybody who eats garlic and comes into my company, they're banished for life.
You've never complained that I smell of garlic.
I'm too polite. So, anyway, we're munching on these French fries.
Right.
And Al suddenly said, Porky, what are you doing? Because I kept... Every time I had a few, I got the salt cellar and then salted the next layer down.
Okay.
Then I had a few and then I salted the next layer down. Yeah. And Al said, what are you doing? I said, I'd like a bit of... He said, a bit of salt? He said, you've had nearly a whole cellar full of salt. He said, are you mad?
It's always good to get healthy food advice from Mal in Brazil as well.
Well, of course it is. Because
he's such an aficionado of that.
He is, yeah. Mm. Anyway, that's by the by. Now, what I was going to tell you...
Is that your story, then?
What?
That's it? Is that the story?
What I'm saying is the...
Was there any liquid taken?
No. Yes, of course, yeah. There was a chemical reaction between beer and salt, and that's why I eat salted peanuts. Salted crisps sometimes do the same job, but I find...
Well, they make you thirsty.
No, they don't. It's not that. That's not at all. It is a chemical reaction in your brain.
Yeah.
Alcohol craves salt and salt craves alcohol. That is a known scientific fact.
Sounds like you crave alcohol and salt.
No. It's a known scientific fact. Now, what I was going to say to you was, is that on that basis, the peanut needs to be greasy so that the salt sticks to the peanuts and doesn't sink to the bottom of the packet.
Yes.
Do you understand that?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
Right.
Well, there's two kinds of salted peanuts, aren't there?
What?
There's the ones that are kind of greasy to the touch.
Yes, yes.
And there's the ones that feel kind of drier.
I like the dry ones with the salt.
Yeah.
But I don't know how the salt sticks to them, that's all. I think it must be wet salt or something.
No, it's probably some horrendous chemical
combination. No, listen, what I wanted to tell you about was I came across this other thing, right?
Yeah.
That in some establishments now, maybe even workplaces, but certainly local authority offices and all that, toasters are being banned.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they banned them here, didn't they? For
Why?
Exactly the same reason,
Why?
Because somebody set the smoke alarm off.
Oh, is that the reason?
Yeah.
Well, no, the reason...
Well, that's why they're not allowing people to use them.
Right, well, the reason they're being banned in local authority places, particularly, you know, councils of a sort of, what could you call them, a left-wing persuasion, maybe?
Oh,
or,
really?
Or something like that.
You mean Labour-run councils?
Yeah, maybe, yeah. That's the report I've had.
Yeah.
Is because they think it's wasting too much energy making toast.
Well, how else are you supposed to make toast?
Well, you don't.
They're going to give people a fire.
No, they want to encourage you to eat, like...
You're sure it's not because
lettuce.
Of the health and safety aspect?
No.
Because every time the smoke alarm goes off, they probably have to evacuate
the
building.
No, listen to this. This comes from employees at City Hall in Bradford were told that using toasters, fans, portable heaters and hairdryers breached the council's eco-friendly...
All right. Hairdryers?
Yeah,
eco. Why don't you have a hairdryer in the office?
I don't know. Eco-friendly standards on supply of power, right?
Hot air hairdryer.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. It also implores...
Well, I mean, to be honest, if they claim that they're saving money and they are a taxable, taxpayers-run organisation, then I don't mind if they save money.
Well, I think it's just so pathetic. It also...
I don't care if people in Bradford Council can't use a toaster.
It goes up... Well,
I care less.
I care for the people of Bradford.
No, you don't.
Bradford's a good town.
Rubbish.
I stayed there a lot during the Ripper inquiry.
Did you?
Yes.
Before you helped the police solve the crime.
Yes, that's right, yeah. Yeah. I don't know why you're laughing.
Well, because you didn't.
I did.
No, you didn't.
I did.
No, don't tell the story again, because you didn't.
I did. But anyway, we'll move on.
Yeah.
Ripper's going to be moved back from Quantry Ports from...
He's not mad anymore, apparently.
Not mad, and he's going into jail.
That's all right, then.
Yeah. But anyway, look, just to finish this off, the Bradford Council also say we're removing the small bins and putting in big recycling bins, okay? But all the other people who work there are saying it's absolutely silly. We want our toast back, and they're going to have a demonstration. Please can we have our toasters back?
Oh, great. Why don't they go on strike while they're at it?
Toasters Ludicrous. Are not permitted in council buildings, especially Grade 1 listed City Hall.
We're not allowed to have toasters here.
Hey?
We're not allowed to have toasters here.
I don't understand that. I don't understand that.
Because people burnt the toast and there was a fire alarm went off.
If you turn the setting down to 3 on a toaster, it doesn't burn the toast.
That
if you're an idiot
on what bread,
and you have it at 6
depends
or 7,
what colour the bread is.
You burn the toast
and it's
black.
No, it depends what colour the bread is.
No, it doesn't.
It does. You have to change the... you have to change the number depending on the bread. Of course you do.
Oh, it's a drivel, that is.
You have no idea. This is Talk Sport.
The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast on Talk Sport with the Ford Ranger. It's the breakfast show that doesn't compromise on delivering the biggest names from the world of sport.
Join me from 6 o'clock on the Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast.
Cramming more into 4 hours every morning than you thought possible. The Alan Brazil Sports Breakfast. Weekday mornings from 6 on Talk Sport with the Ford Ranger. Ruthlessly tested across the harshest terrain on earth. Find out more at ford.co.uk.
Ever made a cuppa and just left a teaspoon by the sink? It's only a spoon. Someone else will wash that up. Or spotted a lost glove on the pavement? You could pop it on the railings or... Nah, someone else will. Maybe you made an appointment to give blood, but the day comes and you think, someone else will do it, they won't miss my donation. Well, you're not the only one. More blood donation appointments are missed at this time of year than at any other. You really matter. So don't leave it to someone else. Book and keep your appointment. Do something amazing. Give blood.
Make sure you're ahead of the game and listen to Kickoff on TalkSport with 888 Sport. Bet you can. Tonight from 7, get in-depth analysis, heavyweight pundit opinion and outspoken fan reaction on the nation's most passionate pre-match football forum.
You won't miss a trick, flick or kick of any of the action.
Plus, hear the latest form and odds ahead of all the matches that matter from 888 Sport's On The Ball Bet Spurt. Kickoff. Weeknights from 7 on Talk Sport with 888 Sport. Bet you can.
Christmas 2015 on Talk Sport. Festive football.
Oh, he's done it!
Fans and phone calls.
What do you think of Super Trump?
Ho, ho, ho.
Talk Sport, we are the two mics. I bet you don't know what that piece of music is.
It's quite rhythmy.
Yeah. From a TV show.
TV show.
But I doubt you'd have seen it.
No, go on, tell me.
Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
No, never seen it.
No?
No.
Don't like all that. I'll tell you actually a story about Buffy the Vampire Slayer. There was a, I never used to watch it that much, but my daughter used to watch it, you know, incessantly when she was a teenager.
Right.
And we were in New York once, and I took her up to Elaine's. I said, you should probably come and see what Elaine's is like.
Elaine's, the restaurant.
Yeah, the restaurant.
Where Phil Spector used to
the bar.
Go.
Well, it was a sort of haunt of various celebrities and, and stuff. And there was always that round table in the middle where Elaine used to entertain people.
Yeah.
And where Mickey Brennan, in fact, our photographer friend, had one of his major faux pas where he staggered up there after, you know, a night of consuming all manner of things and was invited by Elaine, because she quite fancied him, to sit down at the table.
Yeah.
And he said, there are all these people there. He said, I don't really know who any of them were. And they were all talking about Hollywood and, you know, films and what they liked. And there was this old guy there, and he said something to me. And I said, well, what do you know about movies, you know? And he went, I'm Kirk Douglas. But anyway, we went there, and this woman from who was the second sort of star of Buffy the Vampire Slayer was having dinner. And so Emma was absolutely beside herself with excitement.
And did you get a talk with her?
Yeah, I said, well, just go over and talk to her. I'm sure she'll be fine. And so she was, and, you know, they sat down and had a chat.
Of course, didn't take pictures in those days, did they?
Not really,
it was all
no.
autographs, wasn't
no.
it?
No. Yeah. Well, it was all just autographs. I don't think she even got an autograph. She was just delighted to be in the same place.
Yeah, well, that's nice. That's good.
Yeah.
Mickey, of course, was so mad that he used to, I mean, his head used to go right over the place. And I remember one time he wanted somebody thrown out of a restaurant because they were Japanese, because he claimed that his father had been tortured in a Japanese prisoner of war camp.
I remember that.
In fact, his father was never
in
Japan.
Been anywhere near it.
No,
exactly. Now, Ben has tweeted in. I'll talk to you about vampires in a minute. Yeah. Ben has tweeted. Yeah. He says, has Porky brought his astronaut certificate in? It's a good question.
You don't actually get a certificate saying
you
you're
said
an astronaut.
You had a certificate.
Well, only I've got a certificate to say that I flew in Concorde.
Oh, right. And that's, no, but you said that you were an astronaut.
Yeah, well, you qualify as an astronaut if you fly over 55,000 feet, and we flew at 60,000 feet. That's the only point I was making. I thought everybody knew that.
Yeah, right.
Now,
how about this from Stuart? The numbers on a toaster are the minutes. I'm sad to say I didn't know that until recently.
No, they're not.
No, they're not.
No, it's the level.
Who's told you that, Stuart?
It's the level of intensity of the heat that you want inside your toaster. It's not to do with minutes.
Right.
That's I mean, that's daft. That if you put it on six, it'll go on fire because it'll be in.
Now, how about this one from Dave? Who's in a truck working? He says, "Mike Parry, you annoy me immensely, but we share a common hatred of onions."
Oh, right.
Mike Graham should know that authentic spaghetti bolognese doesn't have onion in it. It's added by con artists to reduce the expense on meat. Absolute rubbish.
No, that's
he says,
true.
My bolognese has meat, tomatoes, tomato puree, garlic, red wine, beef stock, basil, and seasoning.
Well,
no onion.
That's
just
all.
Just like Mama used to make.
That's all the same as mine, except without the garlic.
No, no, you don't put beef stock in it, do you?
Yeah, I do.
You don't put basil in it?
Yes, I do. I put basil in
it.
I thought
you put oregano in it.
No, no, I love basil.
You put basil.
Basil is my favourite.
You put tomato puree in it?
My favourite. No, I don't.
No.
I put real tomatoes in it.
Yeah, but you should put both in, because it thickens it up.
Okay.
How about red wine?
I might try a bit of splash of red wine, but not necessarily. But I won't put garlic in. Now, I bought a tin of spaghetti bolognese once, right?
A tin?
Yeah, I did, honestly. Because I thought, that'd be a nice snack, you know what I mean? But
nice
like beans
snack.
On toast, yeah.
Well, and, so you put it on toast?
No, I was going to eat it like, I don't
just
know.
Just out of the can?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Well, not out of the can. I was going to put it in a pan, obviously, and eat it up and eat it. But anyway, the minute I opened it and took the lid off, the smell of garlic was so strong, I threw it away. I thought, I can't put that in my mouth.
There's no garlic in a tin of spaghetti bolognese.
There is. Believe me, you go and buy a tin of Heinz spaghetti bolognese.
Thanks. No, I'm not
going
to.
Open it, and I will prove to be right. Listen, I want to tell you about...
Well, hang on, I've got to tell you about vampires first, because there's an amazing story.
Oh,
you know how you've got this great admiration for a comrade of Vladimir Putin?
Well, I think he's a strong man, and I have admiration for strong people, as long as they're not crooks or thieves or bullies or dictators.
Well, luckily, he's not any of those things, right? Now, there's a story going around, the latest conspiracy theorist is putting this around, that basically they've discovered pictures of a man who looks exactly like Vladimir Putin, except these pictures were taken in 1920,
really?
And 1941.
Wow.
Right? Now, bizarrely, you might think this is bizarre. I don't. Having used to talk to an awful lot of people who believed in all this nonsense, it's led some people to speculate on social media that Vladimir Putin is immortal and can time travel.
Can I see the pictures, please?
The pictures are right here.
Right, okay.
You can see them there. They are almost identical to Vladimir Putin.
Golly, that is uncanny.
Isn't it?
1921, you could sort of get away with and say, well, that's a young man. But 1941, the Russian pilot about to get into his aeroplane looks exactly like the modern-day Vladimir Putin.
Yeah. I mean, it's absolutely uncanny.
Which means, and I reckon that guy, that pilot, the minimum age is 21, which means he would have been born in 1920, which would mean that Vladimir Putin would by now be 95 years of age, which he isn't.
Well, he's not.
So that's rather
isn't that
remarkable.
Spooky? Mm. Isn't that spooky?
That is, yeah.
Others believe that Putin, they say, may have sat for Da Vinci when he painted the Mona Lisa and lived as Vlad the Impaler.
I can see the likeness between the Mona Lisa and Vladimir Putin. Yeah. I can see the bone structure in the face, definitely.
And they say that he's obviously much more than what he's apparently supposed to be, which is a 63-year-old workout buff with a penchant for riding horses without his shirt on.
Yeah, that's right. They say
I mean, this is how mad some of these conspiracy theorists are. They say he may be some kind of mythical creature who is ageless and can time travel.
Well, I mean, we would dismiss that out of hand as being completely ridiculous, but... what do we know about things in life that we don't know about?
Well, that's very true. I'm going to tell you another story, but I'll wait until the next hour, where lately there's been a spate of doppelganger sightings, right? There's a young woman from Ireland who met up with a woman from Sweden, and they look exactly the same.
Well, there's bound to be people in the world who look like you. And funny enough, all the time I see...
I hope there isn't anyone who looks like you in the rest of the
there
world.
There are. I see tweet pictures all the time. People who say, oh, is Porky doing this, doing that. And they're people who look a bit like me.
Yeah.
And in fact, there are a few people who look like you.
Look
Michael Gove.
Two. Look at these two.
Yeah.
Those two women are not related.
Yeah.
One is from Ireland.
They look like twins.
One is
they?
From Sweden.
Yeah, it is amazing, but it's bound to happen with so many people in
well,
the world.
I don't know that it is.
Of course it is.
There's surely so the whole point of the human race is that everybody's DNA is different.
Yeah.
Therefore, everybody's features are different. Yes, you can have people that look a bit similar.
Yeah.
But, I mean, some of this stuff is absolutely unbelievable.
Yeah, well...
I'm going to tweet out this picture of these girls that met
I'll tell you, you look
very
like,
recently.
You look like Michael Gove, who's the...
Some people have said that.
...the former education secretary.
Yeah, I think that's just the glasses,
he's now... What is he now? Leader of the House or something?
No, is he not in charge of... I can't remember what
Chief Whip, is he?
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that, yeah. Also, Tom... what's his name? Tom Watson, is it?
I don't look like Tom Watson.
You do, with
no,
the glasses and
he's
all that.
He's a great big fat bloke.
Yeah, he's got a big fat face like yours.
Yeah. No, I don't look anything like him.
And I think you look like him.
No, he looks like Billy Bunter.
And also, there's some political pundit comes on some obscure political
these two guys.
Television show.
These are two other guys that met up and are exactly
amazing.
Identical.
Amazing. On a Sunday morning, who looks exactly like you.
Yeah, there's a guy that goes on BBC.
What's his name?
I don't know. He goes on BBC Breakfast.
And
I think,
It could be you.
And no,
he,
not
in
at
fact,
all.
If you
no,
ever
it could
became,
be me on a bad day.
If you ever became a reasonable journalist,
here's
you might get
two.
Onto television one day.
There's another two.
That's amazing.
It's amazing, isn't it? I've just tweeted that story out.
But as this
have
is
you
not
ever
a...
actually met somebody that you thought looked like you?
No, not really.
Have you ever mistaken somebody for somebody else? I bet you've done that.
Oh, I've done that all the time. All the time, done that a million times.
I nearly did it last night, actually, when I was walking down to... Why did you come to the party last night, by the way? We didn't talk about that last night.
I don't indulge in that sort of thing, to
be
honest.
Well, you indulged in it last year.
No, yeah, but last year I wasn't working that night or the following morning, so I allowed myself off the leash a little
bit.
Did you? But normally speaking, I don't.
Uh-huh.
Listen, I want to
tell... I parked the car, right? Because and then I walked down to the bar, which is around the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And as I was walking down the road, I saw somebody coming up the road who I was certain was somebody from Talk Sport.
Yeah.
But it was a bit dark because the lighting's not very good.
Yeah.
And I got closer and closer and closer, and I was still convinced that it was the person I thought it was.
Yeah.
And I was on the point of saying, oh, hi, whatever her name was.
Yes.
His name, I should say. And then suddenly at the last minute, I thought, actually, it's not him.
Mm.
But I wasn't certain.
Did you know who it was?
No.
It was a stranger then?
Well, I think so.
Yes, I see.
And now
yeah.
I'm hoping it was, because if it wasn't a stranger, then the person that it would have been would be annoyed that I didn't say hello.
Yeah, you ignored somebody, yeah.
Tricky, that, isn't it?
It is very tricky indeed. But as this
you must have mistaken people's identities before.
Yeah, I have.
In fact, you did it at the Hen and Chickens, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Do you remember
when
we turned up to do like about the seventh show there?
That's right, yeah.
And Mark, who's the guy that looks after us terribly well there,
that's right, yeah,
was sitting behind his booth as he normally
does. But there's a bloke sitting opposite the bottom of the stairs.
You went up to the guy at the bottom of the stairs,
and I thought it was him,
and greeted him warmly.
I did, yeah.
Hello, Mark. How are you, mate?
Yeah.
And the guy just looked at you like you got mad.
Yeah, that's right. He was only sitting on the other side of these stairs. The thing is, as we're not a pictorial medium, radio is a word medium.
Yeah.
Difficult for our listeners to appreciate the appreciation we're getting from this story.
No, it's not, because I've just tweeted it out.
Good man.
So they can see it.
Now listen, I want
I'm
to
also going to tweet out the Vladimir Putin one as well.
That's very good. That's very interesting.
That's why we have Twitter. That's why we have social media.
Exactly. Now listen, I want to tell you about something which you will find very alarming, having two sons the age of what, 11 and 9?
Yeah, almost.
Right. Now, this new craze, which is taking over children's lives, involves kids of that age setting fire to themselves.
What?
Right.
Setting fire to themselves?
Yeah, I'm not joking.
Why?
It's a very serious story. A boy of 11 required skin grafts to his back after he deliberately set fire to himself as part of a trend to get attention and up your numbers on social media.
What?
the fire challenge. Now, remember, I did the cinnamon challenge.
Yeah.
And that became very popular, yeah. Obviously. 4.5 million.
Well, see,
today.
Again, this is, comes down to parental supervision of, yeah, social media,
well,
and children.
Well, you're right. You know? You're right.
You don't let them just run, you know, randomly listen go on social media.
Listen to this. The fire challenge shows people, mostly teenagers, filming themselves pouring baby oil, nail polish remover, and other flammable liquids over their bodies before taking a light to the doused area.
That's ludicrous.
You watch it go up in flames, but you're supposed to do it next to a swimming pool, and the next step is to put the fire out as quickly as possible.
What, by jumping in?
By jumping into a pool or even a domestic bath in your house.
Well, you can't jump into a bath, can you?
Well, you're supposed to, you know, get into the bath immediately as you put it out.
Well, I mean, it would seem to me, one, a very stupid thing to do. Two, if you're going to try and set yourself on fire, you don't do it in the house.
Well,
you set the house on fire.
Well, look, you might be able to find some. You were talking about, you know, searching through your information device.
Yeah.
It says thousands of videos of people performing the challenge have been uploaded on YouTube and Facebook, showing individuals engulfed by flames while onlookers scream in the background when it gets out of control. The trend, as ever, I suppose you could add,
comes from America,
took off in America, where a 15-year-old boy was reported to have burned to death last year after his entire body was engulfed in flames.
Hmm.
Now it's claimed its first serious injury in Britain. A lad of 11 from Barnetby near Scunthorpe in Lincolnshire suffered severe burns when he took up the dare on Saturday night. He was alone in his bedroom and he set his T-shirt alight.
What an idiot.
His mother, and I'm not giving any names here because I don't want to encourage this, said her daughter, Lacey, alerted her that Oliver was on fire.
Well, you weren't going to give any names.
I wasn't going to, but I'm only going to give his first name. It's only his first name. She said, I ran downstairs and started smacking his T-shirt to put it out.
Right.
The report appeared in the Scunthorpe Telegraph. He said he lit his shirt once and managed to put it out, but when he lit the burnt area again, the shirt went up in flames.
Well, why did he do it again?
Well, I don't know. I mean, this is what kids do, isn't it?
There's no, it's dares, not what kids challenges do. What was the last one that became a dangerous thing? You know, when they were they would be daring each other to drink something.
Yeah, I don't know.
And a couple of them died.
I don't know, but it's a terrible thing, that, isn't it? Because particularly as, do you remember very recently, Claudia...
Neck nominate, I think it was called, wasn't it?
Eh?
Neck nominate.
Neck nominate.
You had to nominate the next person along or something to
drink. And
what
did they have to do?
They had to drink a bottle of vodka or something.
That's right,
go.
They did, yeah. And
a couple of people died.
Some poor kid died, that's right. It's terrible, isn't it? Because what I'm thinking of is Claudia... what's Claudia's name?
Hey? Winkleman.
Claudia Winkleman's.
Yeah.
A little girl suffered when
a completely different situation.
Yeah, but her dress went on fire on firework on what wasn't fireworks night?
Yeah, because
what was night was it?
It was Halloween.
Halloween, that's right. Yeah, well, that's the same thing almost, isn't it?
It was a terrible story. Why are you comparing it to
what? What are you laughing? Why are you laughing at children being burnt? This is very cruel.
Well, I've got children.
Yeah,
and I realise how ridiculous.
And you think it's funny to set kids on fire?
No,
why do you think that? I'm sorry, you've got a very, very warped sense of humour.
I don't think that at all.
Come on, let's have a laugh. Let's set fire to a couple of kids. Huh? Go on.
Unbelievable.
Get a little lighter fuel out. Here, take a dose of that. Whoosh, look. That's disgraceful.
Oh, dear. This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. There will, of course, be a podcast coming out a little bit later on. Why are you looking at me like that?
Is this a joke?
What?
Our next guest.
What, Dominic Burns? No, it just happens to be his name.
No,
what
have you become you're obsessed? Taking the mickey.
No,
you've,
I'm not.
You've just been laughing at the prospect of young children setting themselves
on
fire
and
milk
burning. No, don't try and milk it.
You've got a guest called Dominic Burns.
Well, I can't help that. That just happens to be his name. The reason I was laughing was not at the prospect of children being set on fire at all. It was the fact that you had, in fact, decided to make some ridiculous link between this craze that kids are doing and an unfortunate accident that happened to somebody else.
Yeah,
Woodenhead says this, by the way, at the two mics. I'd love to see Porky do the fire challenge. Go on, Porky. You'll do anything for fame, usually. Get on it, boy.
No.
I'd be more than happy to help you. I've got a very good... I've got a DuPont lighter here, which works in a sort of 70-mile-an-hour wind.
Yeah.
We go outside when you're finished.
Yeah.
I'll set fire to you.
Very kind
And
you.
See how quickly you can roll over on the grass and put it out.
I don't think so. Listen, talk about heat, because there's a tenuous link here.
We're
going to
talk about Star Wars in a minute.
We're going to talk about Star Wars very shortly, but then, talking about heat, because there's a tenuous link here, it's going to be the warmest Christmas day on record this year.
Yeah, I know, so warm. I went out today, I had to go out and do a couple of errands, and I shouldn't have worn a jumper, I shouldn't have worn a coat.
Well, I was
it
out...
It was just shirt sleeves weather.
I was out this morning, as I said, I was out with Mr. Brazil, and I had a suit jacket on, if you see what I mean, with a pair of jeans, and I wish I didn't have my jacket on. It was amazing. Yeah. It's going to be. December is going to be the warmest for 70 years, and it's going to be the warmest Christmas day on record. I do hate it.
I thought we were going to have a cold Christmas. We were told we were going to get this terribly, really, really snowy, white Christmas.
Yeah, for once in my life, when am I going to wake up on Christmas Day and find a beautiful, undisturbed blanket of 3 inches of snow coating the garden and the trees and the flowers?
Why don't you go to Lapland?
Yeah, I might go to Norway next year for Christmas.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yes.
Good riddance.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's talk to Dominic, who's just been to see
Dominic
The Force
Burns.
Awakens. We'll call him Dominic.
Yeah, OK. Well, his name's Dominic Burns.
So what? Anyway, Dominic, yeah. Very good morning to you.
Good morning, guys. I do apologise for my surname.
Yeah, no, well, Dominic, don't worry. It's just a bit of bad timing, man.
It's just one of those things. You know, timing, of course, is everything. Now, we'll get into your sort of qualifications for this in a little while. But first of all, tell us where you've seen the movie, how long it lasted, what the atmosphere was like. People were dressed up. You know, paint us a picture.
Well, I saw it in Derby. Saw it, obviously, at the midnight screening, and it was absolutely packed. In fact, I think they'd sold out about 3 screens. The atmosphere was genuinely electric. I've never known anything like it at a screening that's on so late. There's people dressed up, people cheering, people clapping. Mm. It felt more like a festival screen. It was, it was an amazing atmosphere.
And was it a pretty young crowd or mixed or what?
It was totally mixed. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was
people as old as Porky there.
Even older, I'd say.
Really? Yeah. I suppose they're the generation from 35 years ago, are they? Wanted to see what what it developed into.
And therein lies the beauty of Star Wars. You know, it appeals to young and old in equal measure.
Indeed. I was reading. Are you a Star Wars fan from years ago, Dominic?
I am. Yeah.
Yeah. I was reading a piece from the original set of the original film, and Harrison Ford wasn't even known because Al Pacino apparently turned down the role.
Han
Solo. Yeah. And Harrison Ford took it on. And the guy on the set who did all the moaning and whinging was Alec Guinness, later to become Sir Alec Guinness.
Yeah.
Was he... What was the name of his character? Obi-Wombi?
Porky say it. What do you think it was?
I don't know what it was. Dominic told me.
Obi-Wombi.
I thought it was something like Obi-Wombi. What was his name, Dominic?
It was Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Obi-Wan Kenobi, that's a stupid name, but anyway, there you go. And
he's not from London.
No, I know. And he said that he regretted doing the show the moment he walked onto the set, because the set was made up of black plastic bags, bits of tin foil, silver tin foil, cheap outfits which fell to pieces, and a shoddy put-together stage which he thought wouldn't have been meritorious in a village hall doing, you know, the Christmas nativity play. And out of that came the legacy of Star Wars. So it had small beginnings, didn't it?
Absolutely. They had no idea. I mean, how could they possibly have known? But at the time, it was just a zany idea. Mm. And for a serious actor like Alec Guinness to be on this crazy sci-fi movie, I mean, you can understand him having his doubts. Mm. But, of course, it's turned into a complete phenomena that it is.
Yeah. And, I mean, without obviously giving away anything of the story itself, because that's Porky's job, you know, if he ever goes to see, he can give that away. I mean, I was listening to Warwick Davis, who was being interviewed on a red carpet at the premiere last night, and he was saying, you know, in some of the original films, the other ones that he was in, they'd actually be given false dialogue so that they didn't really know what was happening because it became such a kind of secret. And there's been incredible secrecy around this one, Dominic, hasn't there?
Well, J.J. Abrams is always known for, you know, his trailers very rarely give away much of the film. He likes a lot of secrecy, and it builds the anticipation. And, of course, something like Star Wars. I mean, I was actually just chatting to a few of my mates after we came out of the film, and strange as it sounds, but to kind of try and explain the excitement around Star Wars to someone who isn't into Star Wars, we likened it to like your team getting to a cup final.
Yeah.
You know, you're incredibly excited. You can't quite believe your team's made it, but of course the whole thing could go horribly wrong.
Yeah.
So especially after Episode One, which is the most recent film, the start of the most recent trilogy of Star Wars, it was so disappointing. Everybody was kind of going there with excitement, but everyone was quite nervous because obviously if it was terrible, it'd just be heartbreaking. But on this one, you know, it's like we've won the cup final. You know, you can believe the hype because it really delivers. It's absolutely incredible.
And were the people dressed up as in character or not really?
Yeah, there's all kinds of people dressed up and everybody goes for it. You know, it brings out all types, doesn't it, Star Wars? So, it was a complete mixture of... the crowd was incredible, actually. It was great.
So, Dominic, if you're an aficionado, which you are of this particular cult, is there going to now be another one?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's not just going to be another one. There's going to be spin-offs. They're going to create a Star Wars world.
Right.
And I mean, Disney paid billions for this franchise. So and this film is, they're talking about the possibility of it being the biggest hit in the history of any film ever.
Yeah.
And to be honest with you, cinema needs it. It's a positive thing for cinema because it's going to reinvigorate it. You know, kids are going to go and see this and
The strange thing is the cinema was, the death knell was tolling for the cinema just about the time when MG and I got to America the first time in the early 80s, because that was when video started coming out. Nobody said cinema's over. So the cinema industry only had one option, that was to react. And they reacted in a way where a cinematic visit now is a great experience, where it used to be rather a grubby sort of chamber full of worn-down seats and...
Well, it's only a great experience if you've got a lot of money and you can pay to go and see it and pay them through the nose to do it.
Yeah, but I think it is a great experience, Dominic.
When was the last time you went to the cinema?
Well, not so recently, but I do go down in Portsmouth. There's a View cinema. Is it View? Is it called View?
Yeah, what did you see?
There's eight screens. Well, it was at the time I went and saw the wrong film because I was inebriated and I went into the wrong...
Was it not the Wolfman of Wall Street?
Yeah, something like that. And I went and saw something else. But anyway, it doesn't matter. The point is, Dominic, it is now... That, now I've
Can
got
you
to
let Dominic speak at
Well, I'm
just
point. I'm Dominic's an expert, so I'm putting this to him.
Well, he's a filmmaker, actually.
Yeah, I went to one in Reigate in Surrey, and I luxuriated in a fantastic armchair, which you could tip back, and a waiter brought me glasses of white wine all the way through the film. It was a brilliant experience.
Well, cinema has to... You know, it still remains cheap escapism. And if you go into the cinema to see a film like Star Wars, it really does transport you into a different world. And even though home entertainment systems are so much improved nowadays, there's no way that anything at home can simulate what you experience in the cinema for a film like Star Wars. It's remarkable.
Yeah, I don't like having loads of people around me, though.
Yeah, no, that's the general rule. Why don't you just get your own cinema? Well, just get your own cinema done at home.
Well, my mate has got one, actually. He's got a home cinema. And, in fact, my sister's got one, funnily enough.
Has he got an ensuite bathroom attached?
It has, yes. It has. And
now, listen, let me talk to Dominic for a second.
Christmas, so we might
good.
Look at it. Yeah.
Now, you work with Mark Hamill, Dominic, because you make films yourself, right?
Yeah, that's right. I directed Mark Hamill in the film a couple of years ago.
Wowee.
Now, obviously, he was the original Luke Skywalker, but I presume he's not in this, is he?
He is in this one, I mean, obviously, I've got to be very careful about what I say. But no, he is in this one. He's back.
Okay.
Looking amazing, actually. He looks great.
Because I thought Harrison Ford, being interviewed on the red carpet, looked a little bit old and doddery, actually.
Well, it's not surprised, is it?
I'll tell you who looked like the star of the show, and without giving too much away, Daisy Ridley.
She was incredible.
She was brilliant at the premiere. I mean, she was just
Is she Princess Leia?
No.
Well, isn't she?
She's the new sort of star of
That's
the
what
film.
I mean. She's the new Princess Leia.
I mean, we can't go into the
Well, the old Princess Leia was that very famous
Carrie
woman.
Fisher.
Carrie Fisher, that's right. Yeah.
Well, she's in it as well.
She's in it as well, is she? Oh,
anyway, I mean, she was so kind of bubbly and enthusiastic and full of life. I thought it was brilliant.
Well, that just goes to show. I mean, J.J. Abrahams is a genius, and he's literally plucked her out of complete obscurity. And in my opinion, she pretty much steals the show. I mean, she's remarkable. She's charismatic. She's wonderful. The world will literally be falling in love with her as we speak. You know, I mean, she's going to be a huge... Well, she's going to be a huge star in a matter of days. But I feel like she's definitely got talent that could break her well and truly beyond the Star Wars franchise.
When are you going back to see it again, Dominic?
Well, I have to admit, it won't be long. I'm definitely going to have to take it in again. Yeah.
So when Disney bought the franchise, Dominic, was it latent? I mean, did they decide, hang on, it's not dead after all, we'll buy the franchise and then revive it? And if so, what part of the buying was George Lucas involved in? Was George Lucas contracted to the old Star Wars enterprise, and did Disney inherit him, or what happened there?
Well, basically, George Lucas owned the franchise.
Oh, I see.
So George Lucas sold it directly to Disney. And in part of the deal, Disney decided that they didn't... I don't know for certain exactly how many of Lucas's ideas they took on, but as far as I understand, they didn't really take on anything. They just completely started it afresh, moved away from Lucas and brought in J.J. Abrahams, who had originally already rebooted the Star Trek franchise to a great success as well. So I think people, film fans generally... You know, breathed a sigh of relief and felt very confident when a director like JJ took on.
Well, why? I thought George Lucas was the best in the world.
George Lucas was at one point, but after the episode 1, 2, and 3 trilogy that came out around a decade ago, I think I feel like a lot of people lost confidence in him.
Oh, why? Because they weren't of high quality.
Well, they were terrible. Yeah.
Really?
Episode 1 was really bad, and they did improve, but. I mean, none of them compared to the original trilogy, and this film, tonight, The Force Awakens, that's left them all dead. I mean, that's how to do it.
Right, OK. Okay. That's
well,
very
listen, Dominic, thank you so much for taking
you,
the time
Dominic.
To come on
well,
and talk to us.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
And, and we must talk again, because we'll talk to
Indeed.
You about some of the other projects you're working on.
Yeah.
Great stuff. So,
just the,
John Hearn will be telling us about it a little bit later
just
on
Just a postscript to Alex Guinness, by the way.
Alec Guinness.
Although he said that it was a terrible experience and it was a shoddy, cheap film and all that, he did, in fact, take a 2.5% stake.
Did he?
Rather than a massive
fee,
because he felt that, you know, why would I take a fee for this rubbish? I don't even want to, you know, I kind of pretend I have nothing to do with it.
Yeah, yeah.
But the 2.5 stake was, by the time it had all finished, $62.5 million.
Wow. Mm. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Look at the time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Actually
yeah.
running
yeah,
off
it's
at the
good
mouth.
Time. No,
you're
going
to have
time.
To go and see this film.
No, I like Dominic. He was a good guy. He gave us a lot of info there.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed.
Yeah.
This is Talk Sport.
Drive on Talk Sport, the UK's only sports dedicated drive time with Sky Sports. The sharpest analysis on all the day's action.
To say I'm angry is an understatement.
Laser guided comment and rapid reaction from a nation of sports fanatics.
I don't like listening to them, I'll turn off.
Drive home with Darren Goff and Adrian Durham, weekday afternoons from 4 on Talk Sport with Sky Sports, the home of the Barclays Premier League for the next 4 seasons.
This festive season, don't just go big on the tree. Go big on style and space too, with the stunning new Mini Clubman. Equipped with seating for 5 and enough luggage room to pack in all the trimmings. However big you go this year, book a test drive at your nearest Mini Centre or mini.co.uk/clubman. Test drive is subject to status and availability.
He's got the numbers on the players, the triumphs and defeats. Got the form on the football weekend and the rumors on the streets. Get all the stats and all the facts with his football form report. Stay on the ball on Friday night with Skybet and TalkSport.
Get unmissable analysis and expert soccer speculation on all the weekend's big games. Stay on the ball on Kickoff, the Players Lounge on TalkSport with Skybet. On a mission to make betting better. Visit skybet.com or download the Skybet app today.
Listen to Kickoff with Mark Saggers tonight from 7.
Listen, Moosh, this is the biggest deal in weeknight football in Europe, and I'm setting it up with the biggest names.
Kickoff tonight from 7 on Talk Sport. Get it sorted.
Right?
Crazy, but that's how it goes. Millions of people living as ho-ho-ho's. But maybe.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Porkyvision is getting closer and closer. A couple of tweets and texts to read out to you. One from Chris in Mansfield.
He's
texted to 81089. He says, Mr. Parry has 7 doppelgangers. Snow White is fed up with losing them as stand-ins while he sleeps. And here's one from Graham in Bath. He says, Ridley Scott at the Cannes Festival looks the doppelganger of Porky. I haven't seen Ridley Scott lately. Have
I haven't
you?
Seen Ridley Scott. No.
And Maxwell, would you believe, has sent in the side of a can of Heinz spaghetti bolognese.
Right.
And it's got the ingredients listed here. Mm-hmm. And do you want me to read them out?
Yes, please.
It contains 46% water, Durham wheat semolina, wheat flour, calcium, iron, niacin, thiamine, and tomatoes, textured soy protein, beef, concentrated tomato puree, corn flour, sugar, rapeseed oil, spirit vinegar, modified corn flour, and garlic salt.
Thank you.
Herb extract, told salt, natural. But it can't be very garlicky, though.
It is. It's horrible.
No, it can't be.
It is. It's horrible.
I just don't believe
it. It's horrible. Listen, I've thought of a way we can make our next fortune.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Some guy in
what do you mean, our next fortune?
Well, OK, a fortune, then.
I mean, okay. I suppose I've made a fortune, but I've given most of it away.
You have, actually, yeah. I've made a fortune, given most of it away.
I lost quite
well.
A substantial chunk of it when you disappeared out of my apartment in New York. Well, which is now worth $1 million.
Well, that's a tough luck, pal. You know what I mean?
Well, I know it's
should
tough
have
luck.
After it better.
Well,
you know?
I should have left. I shouldn't have rented it to you.
No. I told you in good time.
You
that,
told
you
me you were
going to
stay there for
Washington.
A year.
No, I never said that.
Yeah, you did.
No, I didn't.
You did. You told me you were going to live there for a year.
No, I didn't. Look, you wasted the rest of your so-called fortune on buying houses on floodplains, which
not true. No, I sold that one for a massive profit. No, that's not true.
Well, where did it all go then?
I gave it to my ex-wife.
You gave it to your ex-wife. Well, there you go. You see, you broke up a marriage and
well, because I thought I'd do the decent thing and make sure that she. She had enough money to raise the children
and
properly
so,
in my
so
absence.
So there you go, you know. But anyway, look, this is what it's all about.
Yeah.
A guy in Canada is making a fortune by selling tins of fresh air to people in China.
Fresh air?
Fresh air.
Is this what, on account of all the smog down there?
Absolutely. It's
Well, what do they do with the fresh air?
God knows, it doesn't explain.
Do they attach it to, like, a mask or something?
They open it and they suck it out of the tin, literally. Mm. Because there are so many cities now in China where the air pollution is literally so bad.
Yeah, and apparently it's not just sort of smoggy, it's kind of acrid types, you know, smelling foul.
Like it smells like somebody's tarmacking the road or something
like
that.
Foul smelling, yeah.
Well, this Canadian company, right, it's called Vitality Air. It was founded in Edmonton, and they got onto the idea of selling them. The first shipment of 500 bottles of fresh air was sold in 4 days, said Moses Lamb, the co-founder.
Moses Lamb.
That's a great name, isn't
it? That is a good name.
Yeah, Moses one word and Lamb, L-A-M another, right? Mm. So the next shipment was 4,000 bottles. They went in a couple of days. And now...
But this is almost like a joke, isn't it? He's selling bottles of air.
A 7.7-litre can of crisp air from Lake Louis in Banff National Park sells for £10 in China. Uh-huh. That's 50 times more than a bottle of mineral water sells
amazing.
In the same town.
That's incredible.
Isn't
I mean, I've often said, you know, if you'd ever wanted to invent anything at all, you would have wanted to be the guy that got in on the bottled water craze.
Yeah.
Because, you know, back in, I suppose you'd say it was about the mid-80s when
you started
to see people walking around Manhattan with bottles of water.
That's right, yeah.
And now, you know, when people complain about how, you know, cheap alcohol is and the fact that, you know, beer is now cheaper than water, you know, well, that surely tells you something about the stupidity of people who want to buy bottled water.
Exactly.
But the other one that I wish I'd gotten in on was the wheelie bin scenario.
Yeah.
Because now, I mean, can you imagine if somebody had said to you, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, every single house, every single flat, every single dwelling in the country, which counts to what,
I guess,
45 million or so, will have to have a wheelie
bin. But you know what? Funny you should say that, Mike. To develop that, I think the thickest thing that the human race ever did was not to realise until about 20 years ago that you can put wheels on a suitcase. I mean, when you and I first started travelling, when we first went as a family to, say, Mallorca on holiday, right, I mean, my old fella, you know, had a massive great suitcase in either hand, one for him, one for my mother, and us little kids were hauling our little suitcases around. And
then you'd get to the hotel and there was no lift either, right?
No lift. You haul them up the stairs. Yeah. You had to haul them in and out the car.
Yeah.
It was amazing. How come it took us that long to realise, why don't you put them on wheels?
Put them on wheels and have a little thing you can pull out, extends, and you pull it along.
I mean, the first ones were actually not that good because the little wheels at the back were so small that when you pulled it behind you, it kept falling over.
Yeah.
But then somebody said, well, why don't we just make them mobile?
Well, the first people who had them were flight crew, weren't
they? That's right, absolutely.
So you'd always see the stewardesses and the stewards walking off the planes with them.
Yeah, and now, because...
And you'd think that only they're allowed to have them.
That's right, yeah.
But also, was it not the case back in the day when you were a kid and when I was a kid, you didn't have that sort of entitlement. You just went, oh, well, we can't have that because nobody's giving it to us.
No, that's right.
I mean, whereas now, kids expect to have everything.
But I can't believe, I mean, the wheel was invented about, like, 2 million years ago by a caveman, wasn't it, who went rolling down a hill.
Yeah, but he didn't have a suitcase, though, did he?
No, he didn't have a suitcase.
So
of course, didn't
use it for that.
No, but what I'm saying is,
hadn't invented a suitcase yet.
No, the wheel was invented by a caveman who fell down a hill and, to protect himself, rolled himself up into a ball.
Yeah,
and he realised that, hang on, that was.
Was that how it happened?
Yeah, that's how it happened. Yeah, right. and that's easier than being square. So he then chiselled a rock.
Does this guy have a name?
No.
The man who invented the wheel.
No, but he then chiselled it out of a rock, didn't he? Chiselled the wheel out of a rock.
They were the first. Would have been he?
Well, the first
wheel. Which guy?
The first wheels we all know from our archaeological and anthropological history were made of stone.
That's right.
And resembled exactly what Barney Rubble and Fred Flintstone used to put on their car. Right?
Well,
we know that.
Possibly, yeah.
We know that. We know that.
Was the first wheel not invented for some purpose other than travel, though?
No.
Are you sure?
No, I'm sure.
It wasn't used for something else, like a mill wheel or
something.
No,
ridiculous. No, they turned it sideways to make a mill wheel, but they
yeah, but
the
that's what I'm
first.
Saying.
No,
but
no.
Did they not make a wheel for some other purpose?
No.
But why would they have made a wheel? Because once you get a wheel, it's only any use to you if you attach it to something which moves.
Yes, that's right.
So they didn't invent a car, did they?
No, they...
So where do they put the wheel on? I mean, there's no point having a wheel. You can't just move on a wheel.
They put it on branches from trees to haul the dead animals back to the cave that they'd killed for meat. for food.
Yeah, but they must have had to construct a vehicle, though.
I've just told you they did, from branches, from tree branches.
No. I think it was originally designed a wheel to be flat.
No, rubbish.
And to be like a potter's wheel, thing for turning sharpening instruments.
No, that came thousands of years later.
No, I think that came first.
Later. No, it didn't. It didn't. Definitely not. Mm. Definitely not.
I'm not sure about that.
No, it didn't. The idea is you go out and jump on the back of a hog and kill it with a spear, Rambo style, okay, like you did in the film, you know, First Blood. And then you've got to get it back to base. And it was so heavy. Well, in fact, the first wheels were invented by the guys who built Stonehenge. Because what they did is they chopped down a load of trees. Yes,
nobody knows how that happened.
Yeah, I know how it happened.
How do you know?
Because I know. Because they chopped down a load of trees. And
do you
remember
when they tried to reenact that? Yeah. And they brought the blue stones Wales, right? And they thought that there's no way they could have brought them across land, so they put them onto a boat, and they put the stone into the boat.
But the boat sank.
And the boat sank.
That's right, yeah. That was very clever. So that's why they must have come over land.
They could have used a series of logs.
They were wheels.
But they weren't wheels. They were just rolling logs.
They used the logs as wheels.
Maybe.
They used the logs as wheels. What they did is they got the roundest trees because they realised that they rolled. They tested them by rolling them down hills and they said, right, we can put the stones on top of
these. Well, how did they stop them from rolling away?
Because they had a guy running in front of the stone all the time, putting the tree from the back at the front.
No, rubbish.
Yeah, you did. And remember, they had ropes on the stone so they could stop it from falling down the hill.
Absolute nonsense.
No, it's not nonsense. And from that developed the wheel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Certain.
All right. We're out of time now.
Yeah, I know we're out of time. But I'm just amazed that it took mankind so long to put wheels on suitcases. Yeah. And the number of people who must have, you know, broken backs and strained ligaments and, I don't know, dislocated shoulders and all sorts of things from hauling cases around over the years, you can't imagine.
Yeah. Here's one from Ian who says, instead of fresh air, Mike Parry should sell tins of hot air. That's what he talks.
That's very good.
And then somebody's saying, it doesn't give a name, that there was cans of air in the movie Spaceballs, which is about 25 years old. Perrier air. Well, that may well be. But if you sell anything to China, you're going to become a millionaire overnight. That's
absolutely.
Anyway, coming up next, it's time for one of the highlights of the week. It's Porkyvision. Sports, and we are the two mics, of course, and that music can only mean one thing, and that siren can only mean one thing. First of all, it's Porkyvision, the best TV review this side of whichever galaxy you want to choose, really. And siren, we haven't had to do too much recently.
The siren's
the spoiler alert, just in case you give anything away.
We
haven't done too much of that
lately.
But lots of people, I mean, there was a time when you used to always give away the ending of shows, hadn't seen.
About Luther.
Luther's
new
back,
series,
right?
Of Luther, yeah. Brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Is it?
I think he should be the next James Bond.
Do you?
Idris Elba.
Well, there's a lot of people who think that.
Brilliant guy.
Yeah.
Great.
Why are you looking at me like that?
Well, because I haven't seen it yet.
You're waiting for me to, like, disagree with you.
No. But it'll be in next week's...
I think he would be a great Bond,
actually. It'll be in next week's TV review.
What do you mean?
Luther.
What, last night, the other night? Well, you told me the other night that you'd set your TV to record it.
Yeah, I have.
But you were going to record it on Tuesday night, or tonight, I think.
Yes.
Or Wednesday night.
That's right.
In fact, it was on Tuesday night.
On Tuesday night.
Yeah, so did you miss it then?
I'm not sure. I'm going to try and catch up with it on the... catch-up system called?
Well, it's the iPlayer.
iPlayer, that's right, yeah. The only problem is I tried to retrieve something from iPlayer
in
order to prepare for Porkyvision, and I forgot my password.
You can reset it.
Can you?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know how to do that. So I couldn't actually review what I wanted to review.
Right.
And
you shouldn't need a password for it.
You do, apparently.
No.
Apparently you do. Anyway, we'll get around to that.
I don't need a password for it on my iPad.
Oh, don't you?
No.
Well, mine's, I don't know, my laptop. Now, what I was thinking of was...
you do it on your smart TV.
Smart TV, yeah, could do.
You haven't got a smart TV, have you?
I have got a smart TV.
No, you haven't.
I have.
Well, then you could be able to watch the iPlayer on it, then.
Well, you still need a password.
No, you don't.
You do. You have to do it on letters on your hand machine.
The hand machine?
Yeah, you know what I'm called. The handset.
The remote.
Handset. Now,
hand machine.
What I thought of looking at, right...
Yeah, go on. So you recommend Luther, anyway?
Luther will be brilliant.
Yeah.
I'm sure it will be.
Yeah.
And as I say, I will review it in next week's Porkyvision,
okay? Right.
Now then, that leaves us with what is it this week. Now then, have you ever seen Jungle Book?
What, the original movie?
Yes.
Yeah, the cartoon.
Yeah, well, it was on again.
It's usually on around Christmas time, isn't it?
It was on recently. It was on recently.
Was
okay,
it?
Yeah.
Do you like Jungle Book?
I don't know, I've never seen it.
You've never seen Jungle Book?
No. But it has
surely
got,
you've seen all those old cartoons.
It's got a great song in it, hasn't it? It goes like this. I'm the king of the swingers, a jungle VIP. I reach the top and I can't stop, and that's what's bothering me. Oh, Scooby-Doo.
It's Scooby-Doo, yeah. That's from Jungle Book, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that is probably also going to be featured in next week's...
That's going to be next week?
Next week's Porkyvision, okay?
Okay, all right.
Because that is one that will
Are they not shooting a new version of Jungle
need
Book?
Need having a look at. I think they are shooting a new version.
Yeah.
Now then, something which I want to focus on this week a little bit...
Yeah.
...is... the Dad's Army.
The Dad's Army?
The Dad's Army.
Yeah. What, the new version?
No.
Or the film version?
No.
Or the old version?
No, it's...
What, then?
It's actually... What day is it today?
It's Thursday, actually, now.
Yeah, what's the date, though? Hang on.
17th.
Oh, it's the 17th. Right, well, I will be watching...
It's easy to remember the date, because in a week's time, it's going to be Christmas Eve.
Oh, OK, fine, right. So, I will be watching... A programme called We're Doomed, The Dad's Army Story.
Right.
Which is a...
documentary.
Documentary on Dad's Army.
Well, it would be.
And it says it is the greatest... they're not called soap operas, are they? What are they called?
Sitcoms.
Sitcoms. The greatest comedy sitcom ever made.
Comedy sitcom.
Yeah, comedy sitcom. With all the seasons, comfort and joy, but none of the mawkishness... It dramatised the delightful cockle-warming story. What's your problem?
Cockle-warming story?
Yes, 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 cockle-warming story.
Who's written that?
Of how this is...
Who calls it that?
I penned this earlier today.
You penned it?
Yeah, of how...
There's no such thing as a cockle-warming story.
It is a cockle-warming story. Of how two middle-aged has-beens, who were called Jimmy Perry and David Croft...
This reminds me of our show you're talking about.
No... No.
Two middle-aged has-beens.
Triumphed over adversity to create a great British sitcom.
Okay? Oh, you're talking about the Frenet and the other guy, Croft.
No. Jimmy Perry
and Croft,
David Croft, that's right.
Yeah. Ian Frenet
so
is the other guy.
So they made a great series, OK?
They wrote a lot of stuff, didn't they?
They did.
Right.
Now then, it had amiable charm. Amiable charm.
Okay? Amiable?
Amiable charm.
You mean amiable?
Amiable charm.
Amiable?
Amiable, yeah. And let me see.
We all know what was in Dad's Army.
Yes.
I mean, what's the point of making a documentary about it?
Well, because I think they're making a new one.
Yeah, they are. They're making a movie version of it.
Oh, okay. Well, that's...
Because there was a story, was there not, a few weeks ago.
That's what it's all about.
Saying that Mrs. Mannering, for the first time, is actually going to be making an appearance.
I see.
And she's actually going to be portrayed by somebody, and she never was.
Okay.
Ever.
Okay.
She was referred to, yes. But she was never actually seen.
Well, you see, that's a bit like Columbo, isn't it? You know, my wife, she never appeared, right?
No, that's true.
And neither in...
Although in a Columbo quiz, did we not reveal that she made some small appearance?
Right, some
TV movie,
and also in Minder.
The Minder?
Yeah, no, Minder. In Minder, who was the main character in that?
In Minder?
Yeah.
Well, Arthur Daly.
Arthur Daly, Mrs. Daly never
George
appeared.
George Cole.
Her indoors, okay. So, what are we left with here? What are we left with? We are left with... Oh, right, now then, Prey.
You started talking about that last week. You quite liked it. This is the Inspector Gimp thing, isn't it?
No.
I know, that's Cuffs.
That's Cuffs, yeah. Now, Prey...
And what is Prey about?
It's about the mad... It's about the prison officer in the women's prison who's had to go on the run with a woman prisoner...
Right.
...because she's being transferred from prison to hospital...
Yeah.
...after falsely alleging she was ill.
Yeah.
And on the way, they try to spring her to villains...
But then you said there was something about a dead body in a car or something.
No, what happened was, the villains kidnapped the daughter of the prison officer who had to escort this woman to prison, hospital.
Yeah.
And said...
Well, you told us all this last week.
Yeah, well, I'm
What's
just...
What's happened this week?
I'm just recapping, hang on. And you've got to free her or we kill your daughter. And
that sounds terribly dramatic.
It's very dramatic. And so obviously that put the prison officer in a bit of a dilemma, from which in this week's episode he tried to extricate himself.
Did he?
Yes.
And how did he manage to do that?
Well, he went on the run.
Did he?
He went on the run. Sorry, what's your problem? But the problem is being on the run is difficult because he's handcuffed to the woman prisoner.
Well, you can't really go on a run when you're handcuffed to someone, can you?
Well, they're running together. She doesn't want to go back to prison.
But there's a limit to how far you could get.
And it looks like he...
Weren't they being chased by people with guns?
Yes. Yeah. And also...
Why didn't they shoot them?
Why
didn't they just shoot them?
Oh, I don't know.
The people with the guns, I mean.
They were chased by dogs as well. A lot of police right. dogs. Now, also, the update to... what's it called again? Prey. That's Prey. Right. Is that he has now inadvertently killed somebody by mistake.
What, while he's been on the run?
Yes, yes, yes. That's right, yeah, yeah, yeah.
How did he manage that, then?
He pushed some bloke in front of a car.
Did he?
Yeah.
Right. Well, while he was handcuffed to the woman.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. Blimey. And it's because he was handcuffed by the woman, she sort of yanked the handcuff and he was sort of jogged into the road and knocked this bloke off a bike in front of a car, I think.
Yeah.
And, also, I just remembered, we did talk, didn't we, about bodies flying from the air and crashing into cars.
Hey?
Because that happened in Prey.
Yeah, we did, yeah, because I was telling you about that scene from The Untouchables.
That's right, yeah, he's in the car.
And you were talking about the scene from Die Hard.
That's right, I was, yeah. Well, the same thing happened in Prey.
The Nashikori Tower, or whatever it's called.
Yeah, that's right. The same thing happened in Prey. Somebody went crashing into the car, OK? Yeah. Now, there's another...
Anything else you've been watching?
I've been watching something called... what is it now? hang on a second. Hang on. What's your problem? I'm just catching up here.
This is worse than last
no,
week.
No. Yeah, there was a film on called The 5-Year Engagement.
Yeah. I think I might have seen that.
Yeah.
Who's in it?
I don't know.
You don't know?
hang on. Jason Segel. Okay?
Jason Segel?
No, I think that's the name of the bloke in the character.
I don't think Jason Segel's an actor, is he?
Anyway, and another one I saw was called... oh, yeah, that's right. I had a look at Django Unchained. Have you seen that?
I haven't, actually. No, I missed out on... I saw it was on Channel 5, and I thought, it's not the kind of movie I want to watch on Channel 5 with a load of adverts.
I also...
So I'm going to watch it a different way. It's a Tarantino film, isn't it?
It's a Tarantino film. It's about a former slave...
very violent, isn't
called
it?
...called Jamie Foxx.
What?
Who's a former slave. What's your problem?
Jamie Foxx is in it.
Oh, is he?
Jamie Foxx is an actor.
I see, sorry. you see, you reduce this to ridicule by laughing all the time when I'm trying to get to the heart of the matter. Yeah. I had another look at Forrest Gump.
Did you?
Forrest Gump.
Yeah, hold a coincidence.
Yeah, no, I think it's pretty good.
It is good.
And I think the more you watch it...
What's your favourite part of it?
Is when he... I think it's when he's playing table tennis.
Yeah?
Yes?
Yeah.
With his paddle.
And he gets invited to the White House, doesn't he?
Yeah, I think he does, yeah.
As a result of that.
I think he does, yeah. Mm. Also, I like the quote about the box of chocolates. Life is like a box of chocolates. Yeah. You never know what you're going to get on the inside.
Yeah,
remember
a bit
that.
Like Porkyvision.
Remember that. Yeah, okay. Now, also...
Well, you can finish now if you want.
No, it's all right.
You don't have to struggle on.
No. There was something else, and I can't remember what it was now. I know what I was going to watch. In fact, I think I have watched it. Fistful of Dollars. I love that. Yeah. I love those Clint Eastwood films.
Uh-huh.
Sergio Leone.
Lee Clintwood.
And, sorry, Lee Clintwood, you fool. Clint Eastwood, sorry. Clint Eastwood, yeah. And,
it's like having a pet monkey.
No. And there's a great scene in that, which I love, in which Clint Eastwood is in the bath and he's getting this, he's having his first bath. Sorry, can you just stop this for a minute?
I can't stop.
And Clint Eastwood is in the bath.
Yeah.
And he hasn't had a bath for 12 months, literally.
Right.
So he's luxuriating in this hot bath.
Uh-huh.
And this lady's pouring hot water all over him and all that. And a guy comes in, remember, who's lost his right arm because Clint Eastwood shot his right arm off.
Did he?
Yeah, because Clint Eastwood's like a...
I can't say I remember this, no.
No, Clint Eastwood's a killer...
Marksman.
Marksman,
yeah.
A hired hand.
Yeah, yeah.
What do they call him? Mercenary gunman and all that kind of stuff.
Outlaw.
An outlaw. He blew his arm off.
Yeah.
So the bloke spends 4 minutes telling Clint Eastwood he spent the last 5 years since Clint Eastwood blew his right arm off learning to shoot with his left hand.
Okay.
And then Clint Eastwood shoots him dead because he's got a gun in the bath below the water.
Oh, okay, I think I remember that, yeah.
And says, you know, famously, with the cheroot in his mouth, you know, when you learn to shoot with your left hand, you should shoot. And kills the guy.
Right.
That's it. That to me is the highlight of the film. It's a brilliant film.
Yeah.
I advise anybody who hasn't seen it to go and get the old Sky Movies version of it. It's brilliant.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is it on over Christmas? I mean, can you give any advice on that? This is supposed to be a TV review.
Mm. It's on. It was on last Thursday. Sorry, what is your problem?
It was on last Thursday.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, thanks very much. I've got to read this out from Frazzle.
Mm.
He's got a picture of Alec Guinness as Obi-Wan.
Oh, right.
And he just says, this is why I was laughing earlier.
Mm.
So, says Darth, we meet again, Ombi Wombi. And then all we can hear is Lucas going, cut!
You've got a very warped sense of humour, you have.
Still haven't signed up to TalkSport's £1 million football game? Why not? There's a million good reasons why you should. The Selco Predictor. Play to win
£1 million.
And a different prize every week.
This week, attempt to beat match day Mystic Meg Andy Jacobs, and you can win a GoPro Hero 4 action video camera.
Download the Selco Predictor app now on your smartphone and use your football acumen to win great prizes. The Selco Predictor. Sign up for free now at TalkSport.com/predictor.
Talk Sport, the radio station that's looking forward to a traditional family Christmas this year. Slamming doors, screaming kids, the silent, resentful drive to visit the in-laws.
Please turn around when possible.
Classic. Merry Christmas. Talk Sport.
Hey! Good looking. What you got cooking? How's about cooking something up with me? Sweet baby, don't you think maybe we could find us a brand new recipe?
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. That was Porkyvision. And I have to say, there's an awful lot of reaction to it, I have to say, Mr. Parry.
Good.
Kurt says, stop it.
I like positive.
Stop it. I can't take any more.
What do you mean? Well, okay.
You can't take any more. Callie's Disco says,
you can't have too much of a good thing.
Lee Clintwood rides again. Mm-hmm. Roy says, Lee Clintwood was a bounty hunter in that trilogy. Mm-hmm. He wasn't actually a hired hand. Lord Loralo says, apparently Jamie Foxx is a former slave portrayed in Django and another Lee Clintwood film. Mm-hmm. And Michael says, great Porkyvision. Porky is the Kevin Costner of TV reviews. Mm-hmm. Hashtag utterly useless.
That's very harsh.
Becky says, a film called Django Unchained with a slave called Jamie Foxx. Mm. Another Lee Clintwood film. This is why Porkyvision is so great.
Yes. Well,
Age says, Porkyvision is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. Hashtag nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and Hugh says, that wasn't Eastwood in the bath.
Yeah, wasn't it?
Are you sure it wasn't somebody else?
No, it was Lee. It was supposed to be.
It was going to be Lee Clintwood. You were saying, get ready.
It's going to be.
You were going to say Lee Clintwood.
No, I wasn't. It was supposed to be Clint Eastwood. Whether there was a stuntman in the bath or something, I don't know.
A stuntman?
Yeah. What's your problem? They use stuntmen on films. Don't you know that?
A stuntman?
Yeah. What's the problem?
I don't know.
Honestly,
I can't take it anymore.
Are you on drugs or something?
No, I'm going to have to lie down.
You're on drugs? You never seem to be able to take things seriously anymore.
It's just the way you say things. Mm. Here's one from Masha. Yeah. He says, Porky, you're killing me. Mm. Did you say a former slave called Jamie Foxx? What a plank.
Yeah, well, I confuse the character with the actor. Yeah. I mean, it's easily
now,
done.
Here's an interesting one. Frazzle says, all that is missing is I saw this great film called Top Gun. Do you know what I saw the other day? Right. Piers Morgan. Yeah. Your good friend and mine.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry you didn't get invited to his party.
Yeah, thank you.
He was putting out, for some reason, there was a discussion on Twitter going on about his favourite film. Do you know what his favourite film is?
No.
Top Gun.
Top Gun. Well, he's stolen that off me,
well,
then.
Well, no, I was going to say you probably stole it off him.
Rubbish.
I bet you did.
Rubbish. I never knew Piers' favourite film was Top Gun.
He's gone way down in my estimation now. Finding that out.
I'm sure that'll worry you.
Absolutely shocking.
He's doing the old morning show now. Is it three days a week?
Good morning, Monday to Wednesday? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, yeah.
Okay, well, he brightened that up for sure.
He has brightened it up.
Yes, of course he has.
I definitely now spend more time watching it than I used to.
I saw in his... He writes a column, a very good column, in the Mail on Sunday pullout called Event every Sunday morning.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's
about his kind of travels with the celebs, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it all originated when he first left newspapers, when he stepped down as Daily Mirror editor. Mm. Instead of doing the old boring book about my years in journalism, he did what was it called? It was all about stars, wasn't it? You know, The Insider. And it was just a series of fantastic stories about, you know, people he'd met, Princess Diana and...
That's the one I'm in, actually.
Is it? Yeah. Yeah, good.
I get a mention in there.
You do, yeah.
Did you get a mention in it?
Probably.
No.
I haven't read it all the way through.
You've got to look in the index.
In fact, I've got it. He gave me a copy because he came in and reviewed it, didn't he?
I don't know.
With you and me?
No.
It must have been me and Andy Townsend then.
It must have been.
He definitely came in here.
Well, I went to the launch party of it.
Oh, right. So you're still working with the Mirror, were you?
I think I might have been.
Yeah, exactly. Well, in that case, it couldn't have been you and me. So it must have been me and Andy Townsend. Anyway, point of my story is...
Yeah, in fact, I bought a load of signed copies from him.
Oh, right, okay.
And then a bunch of us went to a bar nearby because it was One Aldwych, right?
Yeah.
And I think I had about five copies.
Yeah.
And I went and ordered a drink, turned around, and three of the copies disappeared.
No.
Somebody
stolen?
Just nicked them, yeah.
Absolutely disgraceful.
I know.
Disgraceful. But anyway, the point of the story is, he sort of kept that on by writing this column, and half it's based in his time in California, half it's based in London.
Yeah.
But he He wrote the other morning about his relationship with Suzanne Reed, who was his co-presenter on...
Their chemistry's quite good.
Their chemistry's quite good, absolutely, and she's a very attractive woman.
See, this
woman.
Could be considered to be an extra, sort of extended version of Porkyvision.
Well, exactly, why not?
Yeah.
And to make her happy, he pointed out that it was her birthday, so he got a signed Crystal Palace shirt, because she's a Crystal Palace fan, signed by all the players, and with her name, Reed, on the back. And he said that has now cemented their relationship for life. So small things like that, you see.
True.
So if you gave me a present like that, I'd probably be
a
lot warmer
Crystal Palace shirt.
In our working relationship. No, not a Crystal Palace shirt.
I just offered to buy you the Beatles CD, which I thought would have been a great present.
No, the family
already
got that.
Now you told me somebody's already done that.
Family's already got that, so a bit too late.
But you're
on
like the man who's got everything. You don't like it. You don't want anything. You don't watch any movies. So I can't buy you anything like
that. No.
There's no point in me getting you a signed Everton shirt from all the players because by the time the season end rolls around, half of them will be left, have gone.
Well, I've got...
You know,
I've
Lukaku will have gone. I've got... Stones will have gone. You know, half of them won't be there.
I've got many signed Everton shirts.
Well, exactly. So what are you saying?
I'm not saying anything. Now, listen, what I want to talk to you about is this. Talking about happy, sad and all that kind of stuff. These emojis are getting on my nerves and they're getting out of hand.
Well, do you know what I discovered yesterday? Is what? If you do hashtag Star Wars, it immediately creates a new emoji for you.
Really?
Which is a little emoji of one of the robots in the new film.
Ooh. Anyway, look, it's all...
No, I'm talking about
No, I don't really know. But it's all part of texting, right?
Yeah.
Do you know what makes a text seem most insincere?
What?
And this amazed me, because it's when you put... Well, first of all, emojis on it make them insincere anyway, because you're hiding something.
I don't agree with that.
No, you're hiding something.
No, I think it depends on the conversation you're having, who you're having it with.
You're trying to make somebody...
There's a sort of whimsy about it.
No, you give somebody bad news, you're trying to make them laugh, or you're trying to mask your own embarrassment
or
something.
I mean, if you were sending somebody a serious text, like, for example, you know, I'm terribly sorry to hear about the death of your husband, you wouldn't then put an emoji on it.
No. But
with
if you,
like, weeping.
No, but if you put in, like, oh, sorry, train's late, can't see you till 7:30, and then put a smiling face, that irritates people because you're trying to hide your... bad news with a smiley face.
Yeah, again, a smiley face wouldn't be the right thing to use.
Well, people
I mean,
do.
For example, if I'm going to meet somebody for a drink and it's somebody like my daughter or somebody that I know well, I'll sometimes put a little bottle of champagne.
Yeah.
A little emoji of that.
Yeah, okay.
A bottle or a glass of red wine.
Anyway, that's the...
What do you mean anyway?
Because I'm getting on
you
to other
things.
You
don't understand emojis. You've never used one, have you?
Anyway,
have you ever used one?
I don't know. I wouldn't know where to find them.
I've told you where to find them.
No, I don't.
They're on the alternate keyboard.
Well, I don't know where that is. Now then, the only thing worse than that... No, there's two things worse than that.
Yeah.
The second worse than that is the LOL.
Yeah, I never use that.
At the end.
I never use that.
Because David Cameron thought that meant lots of laughs.
He did. Lots of love.
No, I thought
he thought it meant lots of love.
Did he? Yeah. I said it means lots of laughs, does it?
Well, no, it means laugh out loud.
Oh, laugh out loud, okay.
Not lots of laughs.
Yeah, well, I didn't know because I've never used it either. So, this was in a tweeting sequence between him and Rebecca Wade, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
What did you pull a face there for?
Because I just was told something about somebody's mother who once sent a message to somebody whose husband had just died.
Oh.
With the thinking that the LOL meant lots of love.
Oh, really?
And
it was laugh out loud.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a bit of a mistake.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah. It is a mistake, yeah.
Terrible.
But anyway, that's the second one. But the third one, which apparently is the worst part of etiquette. In texting, is if you end your message with a full stop.
Yes, I saw this written the other day.
What is that?
Now,
why is that?
I sometimes get criticised by people because I'll often, even if I'm sending emails or I'm sending a text or
it's
something...
It's the height of insincerity.
I'll often do dot, dot, dot.
Yeah, that's what I do.
You know, like as a kind of continuation, like to be continued almost.
That's right, yeah.
And I will sometimes use a full stop, but very rarely, I suppose.
Yeah,
but why should it be considered insincere?
I've no idea. But the reason I don't use full stops in text and all that is because I'm always worried somebody will take it as a part of an address. Do you see what I mean? A part of an address.
What, you mean like .com?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Well, like an email address.
Yes, because, you know, these days, some email addresses are mike.parry, .com or something like that, you know what I mean? And the dot is in the middle, so I never use a dot in case people think it's part of an address.
Well, they're not going to think it's part of an address if it's in the middle of a sentence, are they?
Well, they might.
And there's no com after it.
No, they might. Hey? They might.
Well, if there's no com after it, how's it a dot com?
It says in this report...
That's ridiculous.
...by the Grammatical Institute,
it
may be grammatically correct to punctuate text messages properly, but it is unusual to use full stops in digital conversations, which means the recipient will try to work out why you took that extra split second...
Yeah.
...to add the full stop to your SMS and may think you are being incredibly insincere or even passive-aggressive.
Maybe.
Why would a full stop reveal you to be passive-aggressive?
Well, because I suppose it would paint you as a bit of a pedant, right, in one way, because you've actually taken the trouble to do it. Secondly, it might mean, if you were to be really kind of self-examining about it, that somebody was saying, this is the end of the conversation, so I've now put a full stop, which means there's no point in you answering.
It also says...
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to check, actually, on my my text message to see how many I've put a full stop on.
Okay.
Say with tweets. I mean, you don't tend to put full stops on tweets,
no,
do you?
No, you don't.
Unless you're writing two sentences.
Yeah, it also says... Let me get this right.
Go on.
The rapid pace of texting mimics face-to-face communication, leading to the question of whether the critical non-verbal aspects of conversation, such as tone... and expression, are expressed in computer-mediated communication.
Don't you think they might be taking it a bit too seriously?
Well, I mean, what they're saying is you can tell so much from look on somebody's face when they're delivering good or bad news, can't you?
Yeah, I suppose so.
Much. So. You see what I mean?
So now here's one that you sent in earlier. Mm. Heading into TalkSport Towers for two mics with Old MG featuring Porkyvision, best TV review this side of the Pennines, ...
Yeah.
So no full stop for
you? No. I don't use full stops, I don't think.
Mm. Well, I don't think I do either. Here's one. Ha ha, that's very harsh. As every listener knows, I've given up wine, ...
Mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to see. Mm-hmm. You didn't send that many tweets out, actually, yesterday.
Who?
You.
Well, I was busy.
There's lots of dots in yours.
Mm.
That's really interesting. Now, here's one. It's written by somebody else.
Right.
So you don't put full stops at all?
No.
But and what you do is you do ... on almost everything. Isn't that funny that you and I both do that?
Yeah, maybe.
Do you think that's got something to do with our journalistic background?
Or maybe one of us has picked it up from the other.
Maybe you picked it up. Well, in that case, you probably stole it from me.
No, I've been doing it for ages.
No, you haven't.
Now, here, this is another aspect of this. Participants read short exchanges in which the response either did or did not include a sentence final period.
Uh-huh.
Period being a full stop.
Yeah, of course.
When the exchanges appeared as text messages, the responses that ended with a period, i.e. a full stop, were rated as less sincere than those that did not end with a period, i.e. a full stop.
Really?
No such difference was found for handwritten notes.
Mm.
It is concluded that punctuation...
Well, the only handwritten notes I've ever seen that you've written are the ones you stick on my car window after you've gone out and beaten you and something or other, and you accuse me of being something. Now, I've got an email from you here.
Yes.
You've put a full stop on the end of it.
Yeah, well, that's an email.
Oh, so you have a different rule for emails?
Well, of course you do. Emails are much longer. Texts have to be...
Well, this email is about three sentences.
...short and tight. Emails are longer.
In fact, it's two sentences.
Emails have to be more descriptive.
No, it's two sentences. There's some dots in it, ... then a full stop, then another sentence and a full stop.
Yeah, and what's it say? I mean, is it...
Well, I'm going to read out the email.
Well, why? Is it sensitive?
Well, of course it's sensitive. It's an email you sent me.
What does it say? Make sure that...
Well, I'm not going to read it out, am I?
Make sure that you shower properly before tonight's show. Does it say that?
I don't think personal hygiene is a question of my problem. I don't think it's my problem.
It's your problem.
No.
Oh, blimey. Yeah. Take a vote on that one.
Well, who are you going to take a vote with? All your mates?
No.
I mean, one for you and none for everybody else.
No. People who work around here, probably. Yeah. No, I'm joking.
Yeah, they all really like you.
I'm joking. We have no issues on that particular score, thank
you
God,
very much.
Unlike some other people who
now,
work in
this
studio.
Now, I've got some bad news for you on the hangover front as well.
Yes.
Because there's a new study that's come out. Scientists have tried to find out whether there is a cure for having a bad hangover.
Yes.
Right? And do you know what they've concluded?
Go on.
Avoid drinking so much alcohol.
Oh, yeah. Well,
That's their answer.
That's a brilliant one.
Isn't
and you should issue that as company policy in this place.
There's basically no cure for a hangover.
By the way, that party you went to last night, I know you only went for an hour, but, I mean, there was some disgraceful fallout from that, you know?
Yeah, I know. We might have to get into that tomorrow.
Yeah.
Have we been cleared to talk about that?
Yeah, well, you know. No, won't mention names.
No, of course. No names. No pack drill, as usual. This is Talk Sport. That was Mike Parry. He'll be back for the Porky Quiz tonight at 1 o'clock in the morning, and it will be on the US space program, which you know an awful lot about, right? Are you an expert?
Mm?
What do you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, what?
Yes, I am. That's why we're doing a quiz on it.
You're not listening, are you?
No, I am.
Okay, well, listen, it's too late now.
I've had a packed life.
You've had what?
A packed life.
Yeah.
You know, it's a bit like a packed lunch, except that, you know, it's life, man. It's real.
Yeah, all right.
You know what I mean?
It's time for you to pack off.
Mm.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics.
Look at the light!
Don't forget to come back tomorrow for another sparkling, as fizzy as a bottle of champagne, podcast from the two mics.
Why are you laughing at children being burnt? This is very cruel.
Well, I've got children.
Yeah.
And I realise that would do.
And you think it's funny to set kids on fire?
No,
why do you think that? I'm sorry, you've got a very, very warped sense of humour.
I don't think that at all.
Come on, let's have a laugh. Let's set fire to a couple of kids. Huh? Go on.
Unbelievable.
Get a little lighted fuel out. Here, take a dose of that. Whoosh, look. That's disgraceful.
Oh, dear.
We had no idea, really, that anything was out of the ordinary at all until our nuts disappeared.
If you love the Two Mics podcast, you'll love the live show. Weekday overnights from 1 a.m. on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 a.m. and via the TalkSport app. TalkSport, your Premier League station with exclusive commentaries every weekend.
What an absolute corker!
TalkSport.
Kissing a man without a beard is like eating your chips without salt and vinegar.